First item is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private, to consider the evidence heard in the stakeholder session, and to consider the committee's approach to pre-budget scrutiny. Are members agreed? Second item today is a round table with stakeholders on social care, and this is intended to inform the committee's future work programme discussions. And we have our panellists joining us online. I'd like to welcome Derek Feely, the Chair of the Independent Review of Adult Social Care, Professor David Bell, Professor of Economics, University of Stirling, and COPI Healthy Ageing in Scotland, and Fiona Colley, the Policy and Public Affairs Manager for Carers Scotland, Henry Simmons, the Chief Executive for Alzheimer's Scotland and the Co-Chair of the Fair Work Convention's Social Care Inquiry, Judith Proctor, the Chief Officer of Edinburgh Integration Joint Board and Chair of the Chief Officer Group, and Professor Nick Watson, the Director for the Centre for Disability Research at the University of Glasgow. So welcome to you all. I guess I would like to ask the first question of Derek Feely on the independent review of adult social care. Now, obviously, the review itself was focused on adult social care. I really want to ask whether there should be either a similar review of children's social care and about that transition period to adult social care as an issue, not obviously just the transition from children's to adult services, but also, I guess, at the other end as well, to older person services as well, and whether you've got some thoughts on those things.
Thank you, Chair. Well, as you quite rightly say, our the terms of reference for our review were specific to adult social care. I think that the thinking behind that was that there had been an earlier piece of which resulted in a report called The Promise, which looked at children's services in Scotland, including social care support for children. And I think there was a desire not to go over the same ground again. And so we had a number of conversations as we did our work with the team who did the work on The Promise, and we tried to do the best we could to identify areas, as you quite rightly say, transition is one of them, where there would be some overlap and that these things would have to be taken into as any implementation of our independent review and got underway. And so I think there are some additional issues around social work, for example. Social workers' caseloads will often be both children and adults that will need consideration in due course. So the promise was published, I think, about 6 months in advance of our report being commissioned.
And in terms of the review itself, I mean, do you feel that the recommendations that you've made, and obviously you did an awful lot of work in reaching out to people who use the various services of adult social care. Do you feel that even in these early stages of looking at the national care services, that the voices are being heard and that there's an opportunity there for those people to be inputting into the formation of the national care service?
Well, we certainly did everything we could in during the pandemic period to hear as many voices as we could. And the vast majority of what's in our report came from listening to one of the promises we made to the folks who engaged with us was that they would see their reflections and their thoughts and their ambitions and their aspirations reflected in our report. And most of the feedback we got from people afterwards was that we had done so. We set ourselves at some ground rules. We said we would refuse no meeting, so we had over 200 of those. We said we would listen more than we talked, and we said we'd make it as easy as we possibly could for people. Sign language easy. Those wouldn't be bad ground rules for the implementation process also. Refusal meetings, listen more than you talk, and make it easy for people to engage. And I think that I'm now somewhat on the outside looking in, but my early sense is that's the spirit in which the work to implement the report is being taken forward.
I want to highlight a couple of things that certainly jumped out at me when I was going through the report, but also that are completely reflective of my experience as an MSP, speaking to constituents on the issues that they have with the social care services. One of the first things that you highlighted was that the access to care and support is too complex and too variable around the country. How do you see that being addressed by the idea of a national care system? Because I guess that point that was made in the report very much was driving the idea of something nationally where the variability was able to be tackled and the accessibility wasn't something that people who need access to care had to wade through treacle to get it, basically.
Yeah, I mean, there's an old saying which goes something like, every system is perfectly designed to get the results it gets. And our current system is perfectly designed to get us variation. And so, as you quite rightly say, one of the major drivers in us recommending a national care service was to try and remove some of that variation. What people who we spoke to who received social care support described us as a postcode lottery. And so removing some of that was definitely some of the what we had in mind when we recommended a national care service. But we also wanted to see social care being given the same regard as the NHS. We wanted parity with the NHS. We wanted to clarify some of the accountabilities. We wanted to give a national assurance to ministers, parliament and the public about the standard of social care in Scotland. We felt it was important enough to have national strategy, funding and direction. We wanted a national care service to be a vehicle for fair work. We wanted to be able to set national improvement priorities. And we wanted to be able to, there are some real pockets of excellence in social care support in Scotland, but we wanted to have a way to more easily spread those across the whole country and scale them up so that everybody got the benefit of those. And so, yeah, that combination of things, Chair, were the reasons and why we recommended a national care service.
I want to point to another couple of things again that resonated was that the threshold for access and the support was too high. A lot of people said, I did really like the quote that a care system should be a springboard, not a safety net. I thought that was absolutely encapsulates that. Could you give us a little bit more information on the kind of issues around that you were hearing and that you put into the report?
Yeah, so I can't take any credit for that quote. That was a young man with learning disabilities at one of our meetings who shared that perspective with us. People described to us finding the process of assessment and eligibility as complex, as bureaucratic. One young lady described it as brutal. I think one of the things that has happened over recent times as resources have become stretched is that eligibility criteria have just been kind of ratcheted up and up and up. And so now really the only way to access social care support is if you have a real crisis. in your life. And by that time, it's often too late. And so we wanted both to simplify the assessment and the eligibility process, to standardise that across the country. So no matter where you lived in Scotland, you could be sure that you would be able to get access. But we also wanted to get more people into the system of social care support. And for social care to be seen as something that wasn't necessarily just about a crisis, but was preventative and proactive and available to help people live the kind of lives that they wanted to live. I'm sure Henry could speak to this, but one of the things that we heard from his organisation, for example, was that they had done some really great work around more preventative approaches to supporting people who had Alzheimer's. But that had been incredibly difficult to scale up across the whole country. So lots of opportunities in simplifying the process of assessment and eligibility, and just making it easier for people to access those support, and with a bit of investment to get more people into the system earlier.
I'd like to open it up to the other panellists. If panellists want to come in on this, you just have to put an R in the chat box on the BlueJeans function. But I guess the sort of catch-all opening question that I would like to ask all of you is what you see as being the most pressing issues for social care that we as a committee should be looking at, and that perhaps need to be tackled by the idea of, or the reality of, a national care service. So I'll go to Fiona Colley first. Fiona.
Thank you. I wanted just to quickly sort of feedback a little bit on what Derek had been saying, and that issue around children's services. I think that what we hear from carers very often, that transitions are particularly challenging time, but actually there's that wider picture of children with additional support needs and with complex needs, and how do they have access to the support and services that they need. Issues around employment levels of carers and the difficulty in juggling work and care, and forward, how do we incorporate children's rights in any of the moving forward. Certainly for carers, I would reflect that the idea of the system being unduly complex and only there when you're in crisis is one that is that they've had to have. They've had to fight for the support for the person that they care for. Now, it probably doesn't surprise you that I would say that the most pressing need at the moment in relation to the development of the National Care Service, and indeed now, is in supporting unpaid carers. We know that there has been an increase of around 400,000 people taking on a caring role during the pandemic, and that's had significant effects on their mental health, their physical health, and their incomes. We think that there's some real opportunities within the National Care Service, particularly around a right to a break. But that wider question of a social care system that is a springboard rather than a support. If you provide the right support for the person who is currently being cared for, then in effect you provide the same support for carers and enable them to manage their caring role and their lives alongside that. We certainly think that there's a need to look at what carers need as part of this, the choice that they have available in becoming a carer. Those questions we never ask, we rarely ask, is if the right services were available, if the right support was available to your child, to your parent, to your spouse, would you become a carer? And would you become a carer at the same level? But too often we take that choice away. So in general, we're very positive about the opportunities that the adult social care review and this discussion now is opening up about bringing the value of social care, bringing the value of the support that carers provide actually to the fore, and looking for the ways that we can make that more consistent, that we can make that something that is easier to access and that prevents many of the impacts on carer in terms of their physical and mental health and losing employment and the impact on their incomes. So I'll leave it at that for the moment. I'm sure I'll have other things I want to chip in as we go along, but I just wanted to make those points.
A lot of what you've said there, particularly around unpaid carers, members want to come in and dig deeper on that particular issue. Can I come to Professor Bell, David Bell?
Hi.
Hello, we can hear you perfectly.
Did you want me to come in?
Yes, you put an R in the chat box, so I imagine you want to come in. If other members want to do so, then it would be great to hear from you all about what you think the main issues are, but I'll come to Professor Bell first.
Okay, so just a quick comment on your first question. I'm not in a position really to talk extensively about children's services, but I think one of the reasons for focusing on adult social care at the moment is that we know that there are particular issues coming up which are to do with the increase in life expectancy among older Scots. There has been a bit of a hiccup during the pandemic, but it's likely that life expectancy will continue to grow post-pandemic, whereas we know that the number of children are declining. I'm looking at projections that my colleagues at LSE made for the number of people with, for example, severe dementia in Scotland over the period 2019 to 2040, and the number of people with severe dementia is expected to increase from 36,000 to 74,000 over that period, an increase of more than 100%. And if we think of the fact that we have only about 33,000 care home places in Scotland currently, that seems to me to be an issue that merits very significant attention by the Scottish Government, and indeed this review to some extent is perhaps the first part of that. I think the most pressing issue is about people, about the staff, and as has just been mentioned, informal carers. If you look at any estimates of the costs of long-term care, adult social care, a huge proportion of those costs are associated with what we call informal or unpaid care. And that is people having to give up time that they might otherwise be using for leisure or for work or whatever. These constitute the largest of the costs, because much of the support in adult social care is non-medical support. Part of the reason why it has been so squeezed in the last decade or so has been the squeeze on local government funding. The health budgets have been less squeezed during the period of austerity, and that's what's pushed up thresholds for access to services, is the squeeze that has been put on local authority funding, and that then has consequences around the kinds of contracts that are made with care homes and the kinds of terms and conditions that care homes can offer to their staff. And I suspect post-pandemic this will be a real issue. There are already lots of people who have been leaving the social care service because of the adverse effects of the pandemic, and so conditions that were already not very good for care workers have been made more difficult in a way because of the experiences that they've had during the pandemic.
Thank you. And Professor Nick Watson wants to come in.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I mean, the opening questions, I think certainly, you know, there is a need for a review of children's social care. And I also think that transition, we've been recently doing some work around transition, and there are lots and lots of problems with transition. I'm focusing more on young people in transition, but I think one of the big problems is that when we look at transition, we're just looking at transition of just the immediate post-school environment. We need to be looking at transition up until young people become 30. A lot of evidence suggests that disabled people, the transition can be delayed anyway because of the structures that are put on them. But also, I mean, in the EU now, young people, they're looking at transition for seeing transition services going on to 29. So I think if there is a focus on transition, we need to expand it out. But in relation to the report, which the review, which I thought was great, I think that one of the problems I see with the Feeley review, and I'd be really interested to see what Mr. Feeley has to say about this, is because it seems to be presenting two different futures for social care. It seems to me, on the one hand, to sort of suggest that good social care is the product of people power, co-production of services, and a diversity of approaches adapted to meet needs of the locality and the needs of the service user. Then on the other, it's calling for centralisation, standardisation, and institutional power with the National Care Service. And I just find that these two approaches seem to me to be in tension with each other. And I'm really struggled when I was reading through the review to see how these can be reconciled. And because the former is about, you know, we've got the transfer of power to those who receive care and support, and also those who are giving informal care and support. And there's a call for blending of informal care with more formal care provision. And care becomes about, it becomes relational. And then in the National Care Service, the power is placed in the hands of the National Care Service with a care workforce, and care becomes much more transactional. And I think that it's very difficult as well to see how the third sector will fit in with this role. And one of the things that really emerged from our research on the experiences of disabled people during COVID, both in Scotland and in England, was the role that the third sector played, because it was able to, the thing about the third sector compared to the state sector is the third sector is very agile, very flexible, and able to adapt the way it works very, very quickly. And it was able to meet the needs of disabled people where the statutory services, there were lessons about health and social care integration in here, in that the ministers, both in England and Scotland, looked at healthcare and took their eye off social care. And it's not a critique. I think that you can't have the bandwidth to be in charge of both health and social care with the demands that were placed on the ministers. But what happened was that social care slipped out. And I just want to see how, I'd like to see how you envisage these two tracks and how you pull them together, and how you keep the third sector and this vibrant third sector within a National Care Service. And one other point I'd like to make, there's a couple of other points I'd like to make, but one other point I would like to make is in relation to self-directed support. And we've been tracking self-directed support for 6 years now, getting freedom of information on a number of people on various options by local authority. And it's virtually remained unchanged since SDS was first introduced. About 10% of people are on option one, about 80% are on option three, and about 5% each on options two and four. And I think the option one is very, very good for those people who receive it, but not everybody wants the responsibility and the control that goes through option one. And what we're currently doing is we're setting up a system where there's inequality within the care system, because option one is undoubtedly better. And I think we should be looking at option two. And option two is where we bring in the third sector, and we can be looking at the third sector working with it. So I'd like to see more review within, more a debate about how actually this will be realised, and maybe this is the way to do it. But I'm yet to be convinced. I can see why a National Care Service is seen as a good thing, but I'm yet to be convinced that it is the answer in social care, given the infrastructure that we have in place at the moment, and all the small care providers.
Thank you. And Henry Simmons would like to come in.
Good morning. Thank you, Chair. I'm actually wearing two hats today, so I'll try not to sort of overlap too much, but I think that if I could make a point from a Fair Work perspective, and perhaps I could return to this at some point, Chair, but we held a very detailed inquiry over a two-year period and produced a series of recommendations in 2019. The core message from that is that Fair Work hasn't been delivered consistently across the social care workforce. The main issues that we found related to how services were being commissioned, how the balance of risk was being passed from those that were assessing commissioning need to organisations and thereafter to the workforce, and that many people within the workforce had very, very sort of, you know, changeable work patterns and hours, ranging from some people doing 70 hours per week to people being in sort of like fewer hours and not necessarily having enough hours to live off. And I could come back to that at some point today. I think that the recommendations, which Derek included substantially within his review, are something that we should really, really deliver on. In terms of the people living with dementia, the scale and the size of that issue and the challenge, and indeed the National Care Service, we welcome the National Care Service, and we understand the complexities that Professor Watson just highlighted, and I think they've got to be worked through. But what we would point to is we've had three national dementia strategies. We would say that the strategies themselves have been, you know, excellent. The content, the vision, the approach, and the key areas are probably seven fundamental areas of transformation, ranging from diagnosis to post-diagnostic support, integrated care, advanced care, and wrapped around that, substantial work within our hospitals, both general and specialist, and an underlying aim of making Scotland a dementia-friendly community. That you wouldn't really question that as a national strategy, and in fact, it's received quite significant international attention. The difficulty begins when you start to try and implement the same vision in a consistent way locally. What you will see, you'll see small components of that being delivered. So you might have one area that delivers a really excellent post-diagnostic support service, but then falters as you go through the more integrated towards advanced stages. And there isn't a methodology or a mechanism just now of the national strategies having any depth of accountability to those that actually conceived of them. So we've got strategies that are developed by government, that are owned between government and COSLA, that have got ministerial sort of like, you know, drive and policy support. But in terms of implementation, it then falls through to the 32 local areas, and there is no accountability structure within that. So when Derek's report highlighted the gap there and really determined that what we had to do was to give that ministerial level of accountability, we welcome that very much. And what we really want to try and do now is not wait. I think that the committee has a really important role in making sure that what doesn't happen is that the sort of the National Care Service becomes the longest grass that we've ever found ourselves in. You know, we're talking now about a 5-year period of developing it, and we see, as Professor Bell mentioned earlier, the issues and the challenges and the scale of the problem that we are facing in terms of people with dementia needs a really significant level of attention and focus. And that shouldn't all be simply at the end of that. We need to push forward, and we're doing some work just now jointly with Scottish Government to tackle things like prevention and brain health. So we know we can prevent round about perhaps like, you know, 30% of dementias are thought to be preventable. And that's mainly through lifestyle factor changes and through intervention in your 40 and 50-year-olds. So we've got a strategy for that, but that needs universal application across Scotland, and it needs a little bit of testing. In terms of diagnosis and post-diagnostic support, the earlier that we can work with individuals and support them after diagnosis, and as soon after diagnosis as possible, the more we can help them build resilience and retain a really high quality of life. And indeed, the evidence from that is that that will take pressure off inappropriate and unnecessary admissions to residential care. And perhaps for some people, sort of 2 or 3 years might be the time we're talking there, and that's a lot. If you consider that intervention costs £1,500 per person per year, it's a minimal intervention that might return that type of reward. Yet we've never been able to manage that consistently. That target, that commitment, every person would receive a post-diagnostic link worker for a minimum of 1 year. We've only ever really reached about 40 or 50% of that. So again, it shows you that despite strong evidence, strong models, strong ways of perhaps reshaping our system, you never really achieve that sort of approach across Scotland that gives everybody the consistency and the level of support they're entitled to. And subsequently, you don't get the transformational change in the system because it's too scattered. And you don't get the full potential of the national strategies. And equally, I don't think you get any return in terms of, you know, people being held to account for delivery, because there's a real breakdown there between these national strategies and local delivery. I'll probably stop there, Chair.
And a lot of what all of you are saying, as I say, members are wanting to come in. I'm going to bring in Judith Proctor before I go back to Derek Feely for sort of to round this off, and then come to my colleagues. Ms. Proctor.
Thank you. Good morning, Committee. Good morning, Chair. I think it's a really, really important debate, and Chief Officers are really keen to be involved in the discussions about the development of the National Care Service. But just in relation to your question about the things I think are most pressing around that, I think they have been touched on already this morning, and they are for me around the workforce, preparing the workforce for the future, and the resources required to achieve the sort of equity of access, equity of outcomes for people. I think the whole issue of creating really good jobs for people and making care be seen as a career somebody would aspire to and have opportunity in is also really, really important in that. We have got some challenges right at this moment in terms of the workforce providing care and support for people. And I think could be doing more in relation to terms and conditions, making these good jobs and so on. I think I'd also want to point out the issue, because I think it came up when Derek Feely was talking about that ambition that set out that I think I would really, really support in the National Care Service for access to be equal for people, for it to be easy for people. But would want to point out to the committee that the way that we're set up at the moment, as you understand, we're not all set up in the same way, and not all systems locally have the same resources to deliver these services. Resources aren't necessarily allocated in the same way. And over the years, we've seen those differences, the allocation of social care funding for adults in particular. So I think key to the development of the National Care Service as we go forward has to be the fair and equal allocation of resources, whatever the structures are that emerge from that, so we can create that fairness, equity, access across Scotland for people. Recognising, of course, that we will see some variation there just in terms of the different geographies, different areas as well. I'd also agree with Professor Watson, his points that there are many other things that will create a sort of springboard in people's lives than formal services alone. And I do think the work that happens in the creation of the National Care Service has to think about the sort of community support that we would want to see. I think the things that really support people outside formal services are thriving and vibrant communities, and those community opportunities that are usually delivered very locally by local community groups, third sector. And it's really important as we develop the NCS to engage with third sector organisations, really think about that tension between a nationally delivered service and nationally delivered standards, with the need for localism that reflects local areas and geography. I would disagree with it, if I may, at this point, however, with the point about it being difficult and not having the bandwidth to manage both social care and health in an integrated system. I think we've worked hard over the years in IGBs and health and social care partnerships in order to create and develop our services as integrated as we're able to do within the current arrangements, and to manage that as an integrated system. And I think what we need are the levers to go further in that rather than retreat from that as a core principle. because we have made gains in that, and I think it's important that we don't lose about the work going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, and I'll come back to Derek Feely before handing over to my colleagues.
Thank you, Chair. It's just to come back to your point about priorities. So in our report, we identified three sets of priorities. And while a lot of the focus, quite understandably, has been on the creation of a national care service, that's only one part of the report. And the other two sets of things that we thought were critically important was firstly, a shift in our thinking about social care support. Being seen as some kind of unsustainable burden on society to seeing it as a good investment, away from crisis towards prevention and anticipation, which we've touched on already, away from seeing social care as about managing need and towards seeing it as about ensuring that people's human rights are met. And so I think without that fundamental shift in our thinking, there's a risk that we'll just end up with a national system that's about burden, crisis and managing need. So that seems to me to be a priority. Second, a number of the colleagues have already touched on this, we thought it was important to strengthen the foundations of our social care support system. So a recognition of the work that unpaid carers do and enabling of them to do it better, a recognition that they too have human rights, an investment in our staff who are fundamental to the work that we need to do, and a way to close the implementation gap. There's a gap between intent of legislation, self-directed support, integration of health and social care, all groundbreaking pieces of legislation, but a gap between the intent of that legislation and people's lived reality. And so that was the second priority that we identified, was a need to strengthen our foundations. And the third was about redesigning the system. So that's where the National Care Service came in, but there's also a need to reform commissioning and procurement. There's a need to elevate the voice of lived experience at all levels of the system. And I think that's one of the ways in which we get to Nick Watson's questions. So I think he's probably right that there is a tension between standardisation and personalisation. But the unfortunate fact is we need both of those, I think. We need to enhance both standardisation and personalisation if we're to have the kind of social care support system that we all want in Scotland. And so we are just going to have to manage that tension in the best way that we can. Self-directed support, I think, is a great example of that. So self-directed support is about recognising the needs of every individual. But the report that came out in the course of us doing a review from Self-Directed Support Scotland and the Alliance showed that we were about 50% of towards where we needed to be with the implementation of social care support. And so that's one of the reasons why we recommended in our report that one of the priorities for a national care service should be to prioritise the improved implementation of self-directed support. And I think that's more likely to be done at a national level, at large scale, through a national care service than it is by asking 32 local authorities to do it, frankly.
Thank you. And so that's all been very useful for us to now dig into and focus on some of the areas that you've highlighted. Can I come to Sue Webber?
Yeah, that's on. Thank you very much, convener. And thank you, Derek Freely, for the very hard work on producing the review that's had much discussion in Parliament already. And we've seen the plans for the National Care Service come to Parliament recently. It's obviously expanded quite rapidly since that review that you carried out. So I suppose I'm looking to find out if you think that this larger remit could lead to potentially, especially with what we've heard today, the requirement and the need for social care reforms in the adult sector taking longer. And can we afford to wait that long? And it can be extended out to other panel members as well.
You've directed that to Derek Feely?
Yes, sorry.
Yeah, thank you. Derek.
So it's taken us many, many years to create the system of social care support we've got just now. To change it will take some time. And there are also some things in the report that we could be doing right now. We could begin the process of changing that narrative, for example. That is one of the reasons why this social care covenant has a group has been set up to start to change people's perceptions. We make some recommendations in the report about further investing in the independent living fund. We could do that now. We could begin the process of reducing the chasm that currently exists between purchaser and provider in the commissioning and procurement process. We could do that now. So, while it will take some time, no doubt, for a national care service to be established, I don't think that necessarily needs to mean that we don't do any work to improve social care in the interim. And indeed, I very much hope that we'll get on and do some of the things that can be done without legislation during the course of the absolutely necessary path of any legislative vehicle.
Any other members wanted to? No other panelists want to commence. I'm actually going to move on to talking about fair work. Carol Mochan has got some questions around that.
Thanks very much. As Sue mentioned, there's been lots of discussion about the work of the Feely Report, and one of the key aspects has been the staff and how we support the staff. And I'm interested to know the panel's view on, just how key it is that we get it right for the staff and we make it a fair work place. I'm interested in particularly some of the aspects that the trade unions are interested in around pay, terms and conditions, and also about it being seen as a profession with proper structure in the way staff are trained and then employed. So I'd like some feedback on what we should be looking at in that area.
And do you want to direct to anyone in particular? Henry Simmons seems to be an obvious starting point for this.
At the start, that would be excellent.
She hinted. Henry.
Oh, thank you. I would refer the committee to the inquiry report that we produced in 2019 on behalf of the Fair Work Convention. That was chaired by myself and Lillian Mercer from Unison. And what we did was that we took a two-year period of time. It was the first bit of work that the convention engaged after having developed the Fair Work framework. And we did that because so many issues have been highlighted as part of the development phase of the framework about social care. So there was three components to that work. And the first was we set up a social care working group, which was experts from every area, from government, local government, providers, and we used that group as a point of analysis to really think and reflect, to take evidence and to take views from the sector, but mainly through the views and eyes of a worker, the lens of the worker. And we commissioned Strathclyde University's Scottish Centre for Employment Research to do two pieces of research. One was to look at volunteer organisations that committed to supporting if fair work was being delivered within the organisations. And then we looked at the issues of personal assistance. And what we found was that the work in social care is fulfilling for those that are doing it, but it's not fair. And when you really sort of try and summarise and look at this, I think there's a couple of areas that the committee would really want to know about. And the first of them is probably that there's over 1,000 organisations that deliver social care throughout Scotland. And within the organisations, there's variable approaches to the effective voice that workers and employees have within that. Some have great approaches to that, some have trade union recognition agreements, and some have none. So it's a very variable position. But what effectively you've got then is you've got a workforce of 200,000 workers who don't have any national effective voice or any national approach in terms of negotiation or indeed protection of some fundamental opportunities and rights, I think is fair to say. And within that, I think what then happens is that you need to cross match that to the commissioning processes that have become the norm since the sort of like, you know, the purchaser and provider split of the 90s. And what you'll see there is that the organisations have, you know, had to engage in various forms of tendering and various forms of commissioned approaches. So it went from perhaps organisations having stable grants that they knew how many staff they would require and how long they would be able to employ people for, to that moving to towards more of a sort of an early rate process where staff perhaps were then not certain about their level of hours and their levels of support, to then really moving, you know, to prior to the pandemic, to what we described in our reports as a non-committal framework approach to commissioning. And we think that probably is one of the most fundamental flaws in our system, because what that does is it asks an organisation to commit to becoming part of a framework agreement within a local authority area. So the content of that, the process of that is actually informed by Fair Work principles. The actual sort of the detail of it is probably reasonably okay, but where the problem lies is that the organisation that commits has no idea how much work they're going to be asked to do. They've no sense of that, so they have to take a bit of a risk in committing that they actually will then be able to have the staff to deliver. So the local authority who maybe, or the IGIB who's commissioning that approach, would be sort of looking to have several providers in order to meet this variable need that exists within social care. So the organisation then commits and signs up and is on the framework agreement and then waits in terms of work coming in. Now that work can come in on a trickle basis or on a really heavy flow. So they don't have a capacity in terms of workforce sitting waiting to react to that work. So what the organisation then has to do is they bring people on in low volume hours, or in some cases about 11% of people are in 0 hour contracts. And what that gives the organisation the opportunity to do is to react to the need as it comes through. So the sort of local area is benefiting by having organisations that can react to need. The organisation is benefiting because they can then, you know, secure that level of work. The worker, the person, is not benefiting. So they do not know if they're going to be asked to work if they're on a 4 hour contract or a 0 hour contract. And very often what happens if they're on a 35 hour contract, because they've got to fill that gap in reaction when the tap gets turned on, they end up working 70 hours per week. So there's a really difficult sort of, you know, risk shift from sort of, you know, the commissioning process to the organisation to the worker. And it's the worker that bears the burden of that risk. Now that's fundamentally, in our view, unfair, because we don't have that in other parts of the system. There are loads of our health and social care system where we can't predict need, but we can estimate it, we can determine it. We've got accident emergency units, we've got primary care environments where it's exactly the same. But why is it that it's only the social care workforce that we don't give that security to? So we advocated in our recommendations that what should happen is that we have a national body that tackles and sets up all of these terms and conditions and creates a minimum set of standards. I would go as far as saying that no one should be employed in anything less than a 17 and a half hour job per week, and that should be really the determined by personal choice, and that we need to balance out this more detailed, you know, understanding of data, prediction of need, to then have a workforce that's securely employed to deliver that, and that we should remove that risk of the worker being the person that has to manage the gap between unpredictable volumes and indeed delivery. And fundamentally, we argued in 2019, sadly before the pandemic, that there should be an immediate end brought to non-committal framework agreements, and that there should always be, in any framework, any agreement, a commitment of employment requirements, so that organisations could then say, we'll have 10 staff that can deliver in this framework for you. Now, that will mean that you know, there might be some gap in that. It will mean there might be times where there's downtime. But the philosophy that's crept into social care about there being no downtime, There'd been no travel time in some cases. There'd been no minute of like public money not being used in delivery of service. Is actually part of the thing that's corrupted it, because that's just not real. And what's happened is the workers don't have the chance to manage their own diaries and social care. They're given timetables. They don't have the opportunity to make a decision about spending a bit more time on an individual that might need it. They're on a task-based slotted approach because everything's so tightly driven, because we're trying to make sure every single penny has been spent to the best value. And all we're doing there is losing value and destroying that workforce. And I think I wouldn't be exaggerating to say this is a workforce that's probably one of the most important, the most significant, but yet the most undervalued and poorly delivered on in terms of sort of like standard high quality terms and conditions.
Proctor would like to come in on the Fair Work issue. Judith?
Amy Simmons has touched on, again, the principle that Derek Feely mentioned earlier. Every system is perfectly designed to deliver the outcomes that it does. And I think some of the challenges we see at the moment are as a result of the system that we have in place, where in some areas, my own in Edinburgh, where so much of what we do has been outsourced, and commissioning practice has been competitive rather than one of sort of co-production. Lots of work happening in different places to try and address that. How do you create good co-production within a commissioning framework? And of course, Derek Feely's report talks about ethical commissioning being one of the principles and putting that in place. I think where we need to start with that is really understanding what that framework is for Scotland. What are we going to use as an ethical commissioning framework here? What are the principles of that? How are we going to apply that nationwide, and how will that be scrutinised? How will we know that when we put those good ethical commissioning principles in place, that the impact on the workforce will be the improvement that we'd want to see? I would echo the comments. I think it's hugely important to listen to the workforce. It's a hugely motivated workforce, people that want to do an excellent job in caring and supporting people and helping them to have a good life. However, we are seeing people leaving that workforce because it's a difficult job, made difficult, more difficult sometimes by the terms and conditions and just challenges that are in place. So I think we really have to listen to the workforce, what works for them and what makes for a good career, what makes for a good job. And it might be a variety of different contracts for different people, because I think one of the other things that we really want to see is a more diverse and diversified workforce. We know that this has largely been a workforce that's been a feminine workforce, a female workforce, and that has certainly not helped in relation to fair terms and conditions, it being a relatively lower paid job. But I think we need to go far to make it an attractive job, make it be seen as an attractive job, and attract a diverse workforce. And I think flexibility is key in that. You know, we should be working with universities, colleges to support students to think about part-time work and alongside their studies in care. I think it gives you a tremendous foundation and experience just that would help you in your life. And I think if we're going to attract that sort of diversity, we need to be offering flexible roles, flexible time for people to work. So I think if we treat the workforce well and create that sort of diversity and flexibility, the people who get support are able to get far more flexible support than we're sometimes able to give them now. So I think, you know, in focusing on terms and conditions, we improve not just the experience of individuals providing care, but definitely also to the people who require care, and I think that's really important. And I would add something to that as well, because I think it does link to the question of localities and locality working and localism, because I believe that the more we recruit very locally to services, we create the kind of continuity that we're looking for in our communities and create better jobs for people, particularly in some of our more deprived areas across Scotland. So I think it's important we really think about being able to recruit locally for those local services. Thank you.
They bring in Nick Watson, who wants to talk on this issue.
Okay, and I think just very briefly, the one point I want to make about fair work is I think, and it, having cautioned against the National Care Service, I think one of the advantages of a National Care Service is the possibilities it gives staff for career progression and for advancement. I mean, one of the problems I think with social care though, is a lot of care workers are working very contained lives where they're just working with particular groups, and there's very little opportunity for employment progression. In a national care service, people can become area managers, senior managers, or supervisors, and there's a possibility for training. So I think that is something that should be recognised. And given that this group of care workers, the majority of them are women, and large numbers are from further disadvantaged communities, this does have the potential to tackle some equality issues.
Thank you. And at this point, I'm going to bring back Fiona Colley, because she wanted to come in on an earlier point before I go to some questions on this from Gillian Mackay. Fiona.
Thank you very much. I actually wanted to come in on Sue Weber's question about this larger remit, and could it lead to taking longer? And I think I will admit to having some anxiety around that. We simply can't afford to wait, and I think the development of a national care service is very important, but we also need to invest now. The pandemic has been and continues to be highly damaging for carers. It stretched carers to the limit and beyond, and it's exacerbated existing impacts and inequalities. We've got 8 in 10 providing more care. And I think critically, and something that actually the system will need to look at, is carers had said that 3/4 of carers had said that the care needs of the person that they care for had increased. So actually, moving forward, there may be more care required. So I think that there's, and we have discussed this with both COSLA and the government, of identifying both investment, but some, for want of a better way to put it, quick wins, of being able to get money into the system, to be able to get support into the system as quickly as possible, and whether that's to support staff, to support carers, and to support the people who are receiving services, but actually to get that money in the system now. Because if we look over the past few weeks, there's been a lot of talk about ambulances and A&E, less talk about the challenges of social care and the challenges in providing support at the moment, the challenges in meeting the demands just now, never mind the demands as they progress, and when we start coming further out of the pandemic, and hopefully we will, that actually responding to those people who have more care needs now, and responding to carers who in a lot of cases are exhausted, beyond exhausted, and will need additional support moving forward. So I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you. And we will be coming back to the COVID-19 and coming out of the pandemic and other questions. Can I come to Gillian Mackay, who's got some questions on Fair Work?
So there was a lot of focus on the incredible work done by care workers at the beginning of the pandemic, but it feels some of that focus has waned as the attention has moved to the pressure being placed on the health service. Are we doing enough to continue to value and highlight the contributions of care workers during the pandemic?
And that would probably be best directed at Fiona Colley. Yes, yeah.
Yes.
Leads on very nicely from what you said, Fiona.
I suppose the answer is probably no. I think many carers and I think probably care workers feel very similar, that their contribution as the demands increase, and the demands actually are increasing. They're not decreasing any for carers. That actually their contribution is overlooked, and actually what they need to see on the table is some clear provisions to be able to support them coming out of the pandemic, support them now and support them coming out of the pandemic, because we are in a position where, for example, as furlough ends, that carers are having to make choices right now around the current Delta variant and the how much more infectious that is, and having to make decisions right now about whether they go back to work if and as offices reopen, carers are having to make decisions right now about whether they're able to go back to work and what that means to the well-being of the individual that they care for. So whilst things like vaccination have made a big difference, there's still a gap, and we need to find a way to fill that and find a way to support carers through this just now.
And Judith Proctor would like to come in on this. Judith.
Yes, I would, because I think it is an important point. There are real pressures right at this moment in terms of care workers. We've seen people who joined the workforce during the pandemic, perhaps who were furloughed or who were inspired to care because of the support that was there, returning to pre-pandemic jobs or moving to different sectors. And as society's opened up again and, you know, demand has been huge in other sectors as well, and we're seeing wages in some other parts of the economy offering more than carers are getting. And people are, as colleagues have said, tired. Carers are tired. This has been a very, very, very difficult period for them. And people are leaving, making choices to go to other roles. So I think we have to do more. I think we have to do more nationally in terms of promoting roles in care, supporting people into care, and more locally as well, as we've touched upon, because we can't go into the winter ahead of us with a depleted workforce. I think we really need to be focusing on what we could be doing now, as well as creating that aspiration for the future workforce in Scotland for carers.
And Henry Simmons would like to come in.
Yeah, I think I would sort of support everything that's been said, but perhaps add to that. One of the key challenges that has always been within the social care sector, when you look across the health sector colleagues and you look across to their terms of conditions, their security of employment, their value, but that often comes from the sort of like the discourse that occurs at a national level. You know, people talk all the time about the NHS and the sort of, like, you know, their I mean, examples that we saw through the pandemic where we relied heavily on the social care workforce, but the social care workforce couldn't access even the supermarket slots in the first few stages. So there's a real need, I think, for us to see, right, we must start to equalise these terms and conditions, and we must really make a commitment, I think, to that social care workforce, because, as I said earlier, they're in crisis. There is not enough of them. And the point I've been trying to make is that we still restrict them to minimum levels of hours, minimum levels of employment, and then use them in a sort of flexible way. We don't need to do that. We don't have enough workers to actually support them. So I think we need to move really quickly and agree that you know, a standard set of terms and conditions is a top priority that everyone gets. Now, the other thing I think the committee should be aware of is what will happen is organisations who have the ability to offer better terms and conditions, and sometimes that might be sort of like the bigger organisation, or indeed it might be the sort of like the local authority themselves. They will suck the staff who are looking to perhaps get that security, or organisations that can offer, like, you know, a 35-hour a week contract. The smaller organisations that are providing some vital support, that have stood up during the pandemic and done things that you know, you wouldn't imagine. I mean organisations have become sort of like, you know, food banks and sort of delivering medication and helping people get money and helping people just maintain contact. It's been a phenomenal response from the sector, not just the social care sector, but the broader sort of civil society and third sector, that really all of the organisations are now under threat of their funding. And very few of them might sort of, like, you know, survive fully intact, which means some of the workers that have been there perhaps will be in a redundancy position. And I think that you really start to see the infrastructure of our voluntary sector is intertwined with the infrastructure of our social care sector, which is intertwined with our infrastructure of the NHS. Yet the only thing that gets the main attention and focus is the NHS. Now, we need to look, I think, across our community structures in such a way as to highlight each of the areas with the same level of focus, priority and respect. And then we might get somewhere and help them deal with the whole system changes that's required.
And can I bring in Nick Watson?
I think one of the things that we found in our work that we've done on COVID and social care has been that at the beginning of COVID, there was a big reliance on family members, and a lot of families actually didn't want people coming in because they wanted to keep it out. But we're seeing also, we've got a lot of people who are concerned that having taken on that care role, they haven't been given the support back again as we've started to open up. And care has been reduced. People are trying to get new assessments. There's been a lot of issues about getting new assessments for where conditions have got worse and support needs have increased during COVID. People can't get assessments and so on. So I think that, you know, one of the things we've got to look at as well in any of this is that COVID has created already. Social care was already creaking. COVID has created a big mess. And I think I to the person who said earlier about saying that, it was Judith saying about the bandwidth. I didn't mean that they shouldn't be integrated, health and social care. What I meant was that all of the focus at the beginning of COVID went to health. Nobody talked about social care. And when they did talk about social care, they talked about social care in care homes, and nobody talked about domiciliary social care. So there was a lot of argument about, can we get PPE into care homes? Nobody said, how can we get PPE to those people who are receiving care in their own homes? And it took groups like third sector organisations who had to run around to find and source their own PPE, and because it wasn't being provided. And I think domiciliary social care disappeared off the map at the beginning of COVID. And it's because people don't have the capacity to look at all of these different things. And I think there's a danger, the more integrated we get, that some of the things disappeared. And social care became just about care of the elderly in care homes at the beginning of the pandemic, not about those people living at home receiving social care in their own houses.
I'm going to come to David Bell, who wants to come in on this, before I go to another committee member. David. Yes.
Hi. just to agree there, the esteem of social care is so much below that of the NHS, and anything that can be done via the National Care Service to increase that level of esteem, as you know, is potentially very beneficial. But I think there's an elephant in the room here that nobody seems to be wanting to speak about, which is the overall level of resources that are being devoted towards social care. That comes through the look at the moment. It'd be interesting to see what happens once the National Care Service is established, how it's going to be budgeted for. But at the moment, it's coming through communities and local government. And their budget increased by 4% in money terms between 2019 and 2021, whereas the health budget increased by 18%. Now, there has to be some decisions made about the strategic direction of resources as between, in relation to health and social care overall, and how these resources are allocated within that overall budget. One point aside from this, which actually Derek Feely also made in his report, one of the benefits of a National Care Service would be an improvement in the data that is available to make the kinds of decisions that need to be made. The our work on care home deaths during the pandemic really was not helped by the quality and availability of data for across the social care sector. And even as as Professor Watson was saying, it's even worse for domiciliary care than for care homes.
Kane has got a question on the specific point around pay. Paul, if you can direct it to somebody in particular, that would also be great.
Sure. Thank you, Convener. I think Professor Bell there spoke about the elephant in the room in terms of finance. And I think pay is part of that as well. And certainly, you know, trade unions like the GMB are advocating £15 an hour for care workers. I suppose I'm just trying to get a sense of whether that's the first step, curing, better rates of pay and more sustainable rates of pay. And then the other aspects that we've discussed follows from that, in terms of, I think, training, qualifications, and kind of a longer term career. So, I don't know if Derek perhaps wants to comment on that.
Derek.
Sure, thank you for the question. It was certainly the case in many of the conversations that we had, regardless of whether it was with third sector organisations or people who receive social care support, it was noticeable how many of them said to us, if you're going to invest in one thing, invest in the workforce. And I think the work that Henry and Lily and the colleagues did in their review of Fair Work is an outstanding foundation for making that investment. In the conversations we had with the trade unions and the discussions that they enabled us to have with their members, you're right. There, I mean, people have perspectives on what a fair rate for the job is. At the moment, we've focused on the real living wage, which, in my view, is a starting point, but not necessarily an end point. I think we need to get beyond that if we're going to see social care as a valued career and for the highly skilled work that it is. We recommend in the report some kind of national programme of job evaluation, like we did at the NHS, which will give us some sense about what fair pay really is in the sector, and that's why one of the reasons why we couldn't put a firm price tag on what the level of investment might be. But for every, roughly speaking, for every pound that we go above the real living wage, it will need us to invest about £100 million.
Okay, I'm going to come to Henry Simmons, who wants to come in on this before moving on to questions from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Chair. What I would like to say is that I think it's been good progress in terms of living wage, but if you have a great hourly rate and you only have 2 hours work a week or 10 hours work a week, it doesn't really matter. What you need is a full package. And I think that I would ask the sort of committee to look at the Fair Work framework. So you're looking at, you know, security, respect, fulfillment, opportunity. You need the full package to have good quality work, good quality employment. And you don't have that within the social care sector. So within the sort of terms and condition arrangements, you also need access to training, you need access to sort of, you know, support, supervision, time to reflect. All of that makes for good work, and we don't have that because the system's pushed that away. So I think that we need to agree what a good, fair, equitable hourly rate is, and probably the best place to look is look across to our healthcare colleagues. So if you imagine the terms and conditions that are enjoyed in the various levels of the NHS have been well developed, well negotiated, collaborated on, and agreed. We don't have that within social care, but if you drew that as a parallel, you'd get somewhere close to something that I think would be reasonable. And I think we've got to move into that, you know, the whole approach, because the other thing that we're seeing in the sector is because the living wage is increasing, you know, the sort of next level up of sort of frontline supervisors and managers isn't, and the gap's getting smaller and smaller. And these are environments that need really skilled managers, really skilled people to coordinate and to work with individuals and to understand that. And if we don't value that level with the same sort of like comparators as perhaps we do in the NHS, then again, we're going to see that gap decrease. We won't have enough managers to manage the complexities of the system, and indeed it won't be worth their while doing it. So I think you've got to look at it beyond just the hourly rate and look at the whole framework and look at the whole system from sort of like, you know, the structures within organisations to deliver a high quality service. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you. And so moving on in a similar theme, Emma Harper has some questions around recruitment and retention of staff. Emma.
Thanks, Convener. Yep, a lot of the fair work issues and the recruitment and retention, which is what I'm interested in, there are lots of like leeching off the issues and the ideas. My first job was in a care home before I started my nurse training, and a long time ago, but I'm interested in looking at like what should we do to help support recruitment and retention outside of just looking at wages. I'm interested in the issue around, like, a Band 5 staff nurse gets about £15 an hour, and a Band 5 staff nurse trains for 3 years looking at, like, knowledge and skills development and competency demonstration and assessment. And so is that something that there needs to be more structure in the education in order to encourage recruitment and retention so that it's perceived as a skilled job to work, whether it's in home care or whether to work in a residential home or a nursing home?
And would you like to direct that to anyone in particular, Emma? Or I've got Judy Proctor wants to come in, but I'm not entirely sure if that was on this theme. Can I come to Judith? Thank you.
To come in on that and pick up the bit of the previous point as well. I think it is really, really interesting. How much do people who haven't had any experience of providing care or with somebody who's cared for know about the job? I think there's a lot of preconceptions about the job, but not an awful lot of people out with it will know what it takes, the skills that you need, the training that's required to do that, and the decision making, the autonomy that's required. So I think we could do a lot more to promote and to explain and to allow people that do care to share what it is about the job that they like and what the job is like. And also in the way that Derek Feely's report drew out, you know, the difference it makes in people's lives, you know, the life-changing difference it makes for people who otherwise would be isolated or unable to contribute to society. So I think it's really, really important that we do that. But I'd also want to point out that when we talk about social care, it's really, really important also that we think about the development of the profession of social work. I don't think in the debate that's having as much of a focus on it as it probably should, because of course good social work and well-supported social workers and well-resourced social work capacity ensures that good access to care for people, and it ensures that we would be able to meet the aspiration for easier access into those services as well. So I think that is really, really important. If I could though touch as well, because I think terms and conditions are very important here, creating that sort of career structure. We've touched upon the keenness for parity and esteem with the NHS and thinking about the single workforce pay spines there too. But I do wonder if we're thinking about the potential in this and of linking these terms and conditions to that sort of structure, what that might do to the diversity of the market that we have currently in care. There's a broad range of different providers out there, and I do wonder, I don't have an answer to the question, but I wonder if in creating that single set of terms and conditions, that single role definition, whether we begin to see a greater amalgamation of organisations, or indeed whether this leads us to that single nationalised workforce as we have in the NHS.
And I'll come to Derek Feely.
Thank you, Chair. I think there are probably a handful of things that we can and should do. The first would be awareness. So grow some public awareness about what a good career working in social care could be. The second is around recognising and celebrating the value of working in social care support. Mm-hmm. We touched on that earlier. I think there is more that could be done there. The third is around pay and conditions. So if we really mean what we say about social care support being a valued contribution to civic society, then we should pay people accordingly. The fourth would be training and development. So we have a lot of stories from people about how they have to do their training and development in their own time. They have to do it in the margins of their work. And so if we believe that providing social care support is skilled work, which it undoubtedly is, we should train and develop people accordingly. And the fifth would be to give some people, and Nick Watson touched on this, give people some kind of sense of career progression. So they could see social care as a career. And so I think if we did those five things, raising awareness, celebrating value, improving terms and conditions, increased training and development and giving people a sense that they could have a career in social care, it would help with recruitment and retention.
Thank you. And I'll come to Nick Watson before moving on.
I think one of the things that Judith touched on this around social workers, that Ian Ferguson, who was a professor of social work, pointed to that one of the problems with co-production and using bottom-up approaches is that social workers can feel deprofessionalized. It can take away their feeling of professionals. And I think one of the issues that we've seen with self-directed support and with health and social care integrations on, been a lot of language of co-production and co-producing services, but it's all been about co-producing and co-working with those who receive care, and that's a really important thing. But I think there needs to be an involvement in professionals in the redesigning of the service. At the moment, people in the middle, they feel like they're being done to when you speak to them. And one of the issues, I think, with SDS and the implementation of SDS has been that social workers aren't really pushing it. It doesn't seem to be being pushed in the way by the street level bureaucrats, if you like, the people who are pushing this out and developing it. And maybe we need to be looking at involving those people more in the design and delivery of new care services as well. And you know, how will social workers feel about being brought into a national care service when they've always been part of social work? And I suppose there's a need to start looking at that as well, about how that will come through.
Thank you. We're going to move on to questions around funding of social care, and these will be led by Paul Kane. Paul.
Thank you, convener. I'm keen to understand, obviously we've moved from, you know, Mr. Feely's review and the work that was done there in terms of recommendations to what the government have consulted on. And obviously within the Feely review, we had the figure of 0.66 billion in terms of being adequate investment for those proposals. However, obviously we have an expanded remit. We also have commentary, I think, from Audit Scotland and kind of questioning the growing requirement for care, particularly in an ageing population. So really, I think just to get a sense, morning from the panel, around how realistic that figure is and what further work needs to be done in terms of trying to understand that.
If you don't have anyone in particular you want to direct that to, I'll probably come to Derek Feely first of all, and if other people want to come in on that, they can.
Derek. If you'll give it a name, Mr. Feely, I better let him.
Thank you. Derek first, and then I'll come to
him. The numbers are as realistic as we could get them in the time that we had available. We only had 6 months to do all of this work, and we spent most of our time talking to people, not doing the financial analysis. And so, as we point out in the report, we've done the best work that we can to give some kind of indicative numbers. Again, I would say those are probably the floor rather than the ceiling. And they exclude, for example, any investment in fair work, because we couldn't quantify that before we knew what would be the hourly rate, for example. But we've, I think, done a reasonable job at looking at how we could get to unmet need in a approximate kind of way, what the cost of removing charging would be, the uprating of free personal nursing care, which we think is necessary. So, our sense is that they're a reasonable approximation and they're a decent place to start, but there's undoubtedly more work to do.
Thanks. Just waiting for broadcasting to unmute Henry. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair. I think earlier on, Professor Bell gave an indication that a number of people were expecting to develop more progressive advanced dementia. These figures are frightening and they're huge. I think the work that Derek did in terms of the recommendations about free personal nursing care are a great start. I think that the committee probably needs to consider the fact that, you know, many of the individuals who will develop advanced dementia, actually their needs are healthcare needs. And just now our system sort of puts all that into a social care environment. And I think that the issue of who pays for care going forward is going to be absolutely crucial. Now, we would argue that it's fundamentally unfair for someone who is in an advanced state of dementia, who can't walk, can't talk, needs assistance to toilet, they need their health care. And we would argue that they shouldn't be paying for their care, for that part of their care at least. And I think that the recent developments in the national insurance increases, contributions and the idea of caps, they miss some of the points, I think, in how we need to articulate a fair and equal health and social care system. And there's no doubt that many people, as they progress with really complex advanced dementia, you know, cannot be described as requiring social care, but they have health care needs in a social care environment. So I think that the paying of that, we estimated perhaps about £40 million above, which is currently in play just now, would be required to make that an equal platform. And I think that there's a real need for us to look beyond just the sort of immediate sort of situations we've got and think through that changing nature of what our care system is working with and the needs that people have, because people move from healthcare to social care, but back into healthcare needs as their needs progress. And that part of our system doesn't adapt and change.
David Bell.
Thanks.
Okay, so the estimate is around £0.66 billion for the National Care Service. And as Derek said, there really isn't anything in that around improving significantly the terms and conditions of existing care workers. Currently, we spend around £4 billion a year on adult social care. So this is an increase of more than 10% that is being proposed. I have to admit that I was one of the people, another was the current chief economist of the Scottish Government, who was involved in forecasting the increase in costs associated with the introduction of free personal care. That was way back in 1999. And I've got to say, we got it pretty badly wrong. We significantly underestimated the costs at that time. Having said that, I don't think that the Scottish Government or successive Scottish Governments would regret having taken that decision, especially given any comparison with the situation as far as social care is concerned in England. But as has been highlighted by the increase in national insurance and its hypothecation and its attempted hypothecation to the Scottish Government, which is an interesting take on devolution, clearly the question of who pays if we are going to significantly increase the resources allocated to social work. And as Henry has been saying, we really must expect them to significantly increase over the next decade or two decades. Then we have to have this conversation in Scotland around who makes a fair contribution. We have to define what a fair contribution really means. But given the way that local government budgets have moved in the last decade or so, it doesn't look like, well, if that were to continue, it's not obvious how additional resources would be found to meet the kinds of demands that we've all been talking about, not only the demand in volume, but also the things that are needed to be put in place to improve quality.
And can I come to Fiona Colley?
Thank you. I'll be very brief. I think it's a difficult question to answer, because when we looked at the right to respite and started to do some figures on that, it could equate to £500 million, depending on what right you introduce. And the investment and what that will cost will depend on the scale of change that you're intending to make. If you're really going to try and make a difference to the lives of unpaid carers, for example, the cost to replace what they provide is around £43 million a day, which is £10.9 billion. So it really depends on the scale of change that the National Care Service intends to deliver. And I did want to very briefly say, I think we do need to start balancing out when we're working out about investment, about what the cost of investment of not investing is. And for unpaid carers, that's losing employment. So what does that mean to the Scottish tax system? If disabled people can't work because they can't get social care to support them to do that, what is the cost of the Scottish tax system and the Scottish economy? So I think we need some more balance. It's not just about cost, but it's what will that investment deliver to the Scottish economy as well. And I just very briefly wanted to say about social workers. The thing I hear most often from carers, very anecdotally, is that their social worker has changed, their social worker is off, and they can't get hold of the social worker, or they can't get a social worker at all. It's an extremely important role in supporting the assessment of individuals and investment within that to try and overcome some of the problems that there are at the moment, I think is vital.
Of supplementary questions from members on this. Evelyn Tweed, and then we'll come to Sue Webber.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, colleagues. Thank you for your contributions so far this morning. I suppose I'm interested in the funding and particularly what Fiona Colley has just said about the scale of change, what we're actually trying to achieve in a new National Care Service, and also the issues of data, etc., that were raised earlier. In the redesign of the National Care Service, and if we are to excel in preventative care, all the new measures we want to bring in to really make it a great service for people, can we also ensure when we're doing that that costs can be contained in the long term, or is it your view that costs will always increase? Thank you.
And would you like to direct that to anyone in particular, and I'll allow people to...
I'd like to go to Fiona Colley first. Thank you. Please.
Well, I think potentially that's a question for an economist, but I think it's very difficult to contain the cost because we have our rising ageing population. I think those questions around individuals with more advanced dementia and that increase. So I think it is difficult to contain the cost and continue to do what you want to do. But I think that point about data and that investment versus cost, and I think we need to see it in the whole, because if you invest effectively and that actually helps with your local economy, for example, investment in the third sector has a multiplier in the local economy. So we actually need to start looking at this as more than just about this is the cost of social care, but that there's wider economic benefits, and so we need to balance them out. But I would say it is quite difficult to contain the costs in my opinion, but I am not an economist on this.
Economist, and we'll come to David Bell and then Derek Feely. David.
Okay, just very briefly on the data, a couple of things. One is that what we found when we were doing the three personal care assessment of its costs was the trying to get a handle on what's called unmet need. which is the amount of need there is out in the community that is not really being registered with local authorities or health boards and so on. And effectively, there must be unmet need out there as thresholds have increased before which people get access to services. So I think that's a critical point. The other thing goes back to something that Henry mentioned, which is around Alzheimer's and the possibility that a lot of costs or late term costs associated with Alzheimer's can be prevented by making lifestyle changes. We are the only part of Europe and in a very significant minority in the world as a whole in not having a study or what's called a longitudinal study of older people, which follows older people as they age. I'm part of the European Scientific Board for the European study, and it throws up huge amounts of research that are helpful around how older people are dealing with the challenges that they face.
And can I come to Derek Feely before moving on to Sue Weber's question?
Just three quick points, if I may, Chair. Firstly, I don't think anybody's asking for a handout for social care. We're asking for an investment in social care. And there are studies that show that it would be a good investment to make. The work done by the Scottish Women's Budget Group shows that an investment in social care would get us about twice as much economic value as an investment of the same extent in construction. There was a study done of the Independent Living Fund in Northern Ireland, which showed £11 of social value generated for every pound spent on the Independent Living Fund. So part of this goes back to my earlier point about let's try and approach these issues with a different story about what is social care in our minds, and see social care not as some kind of unsustainable burden, but as an investment in a good society. Second, cost containment, of course, is going to be difficult, but I would argue it will be easier if we have good data. I think it's an impediment to us exercising good stewardship over our resources that we don't have really good national data about social care. And I think there is something in our recommendations, thirdly, about accountability that ought to help. When I was the Director General for Health and Social Care and the Chief Executive of the NHS, I would come to your committee and I would, as the accountable officer, I would be properly held to account for how we spend in our health budget. No one's been similarly held to account for how we're spending our social care budget. And I think it's time that someone was. I'm kind of glad it's not going to be me, but I think it's time that somebody was.
Thank you. We have a short supplementary from Sue Weber. I know that Nick Watson wants to come in, but I'm going to bring Sue's question, and maybe Nick can come in after that.
Yes, hopefully. And I'm sorry, it might not be that short, the supplementary. Yeah. All right, OK. It's more around the commissioning and the procurement and some of the challenges.
I'll bring in Nick Watson, and but we're not quite at procurement yet. Nick.
There we are. I just want to make one little point about we're also talking about care as if it's one sector. We've got to remember people work in care from three different sectors. We've got about 39% work in the private sector. There's about 27% working in the voluntary sector and about 34% working in the public sector. So the care workers are working in different sectors. And I mean, again, this is one of the things I don't quite understand how the National Care Service is going to bring all of these different care workers together? Are they all going to, are they going to become, are we going to nationalise those working in the private sector? Are we going to incorporate those working in the third? I mean, I'm just not entirely sure how this is going to go through or how it feeds into the National Care Service. But I think we need to remember that care workers work in a variety of different sectors, and they've got different stretches and different pressures on them and in the way they work. But just in terms of the finances, I think it's also really important to remember how many people are employed in the Scottish, in the care sector in Scotland, and how important it is to our economy, because I think nearly 300,000 people are employed as care workers across Scotland, and they make a massive contribution to the economy. And so it is something that we should see as something positive if we turn it around another way.
Thank you. That leads nicely on to questions around the scope of National Care Service, which we have touched on a fair bit throughout the session. I'm going to go over to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener, and great to see you all here today. Now, the National Care Service, we're talking about a significant increase in scope, and I'm wondering about the new Community Health and Social Care Boards that are proposed and how we actually make sure they've got the breadth, the capacity and the collaboration there to really join up health and social care services in a way that means that we're designing care around what individuals need. And I'd like to ask that to Derek and Judith. Thanks.
First of all, just waiting for broadcasting. Thank you. Derek, over to you.
I can go first, and then Judith will be able to provide more detail, no doubt. So we see integration joint boards as having a really important role. They'll be the way in which a National Care Service gets intelligence about local needs and priorities. But they'll also be the implementation arm of national strategy and direction as determined by the National Care Strategy. There's a crucially important role for integration joint bodies in planning of integrated services locally, in engaging with local communities to determine local needs. And also I think about rethinking what are the social care solutions of the future. So bringing in innovative new practice, different ways to meet people's needs. So crucially important role for integration joint boards, and they will be the kind of delivery arm of the National Care Service. And at least that's how it's imagined in our report.
And can I bring in Judith Proctor?
Hope you can hear me. I'm afraid my system. Hi, I hope you can hear me. I'm afraid that my system has thrown me out, so I'm phoning in. But I'm pleased I was able to rejoin. Yeah, I think the scope and the thinking through the function of the new Community Health and Social Care Boards is really very, very important. And I think it's also very important that we give due scrutiny to the proposals that emerge following the consultation on the National Care Service, so that what comes after this is workable, and that we've stress tested that. You know, will the proposals that emerge through the bill process actually deliver the sorts of change for people that we want to see on the ground? I very much welcome the points that Derek made about this being about delivering locally with our communities. I think one of the real benefits of the development of integration as it's undertaken now is that real focus on localities. We know that we've got a real diversity of communities across Scotland, and I think it's important that any organisation is of the community it's serving. So I think that's an important principle for me. I also think as a chief officer who's worked in an integrated system, if we're going to make the changes that we need to learn from the the report, the Audit Scotland report, that said what's held us back, why have we not achieved, even though it's been a relatively short time that we've been integrated, only about six or so years, what stopped us going faster? And I do think we need to ensure that the new community health social care boards have all the levers that they need in order to be the delivery arm of those organisations. And I would question whether that can be delivered through what looks in part in the current consultation, an organisation that will be commissioning elements from one of the partners in that. So I think consideration has to be given to these boards having the operational levers to pull to deliver, as well as the resources, and that question being addressed through a fair and equitable allocation to the boards that recognises that we don't have a level playing field just now. Thanks.
Thanks. I'm going to have to move things on. I've extended the time for this panel. I hope everyone's able to stay with us for the next 15 minutes because we still have some real key issues to. So I'm going to move on to talk about unpaired carers. We said we wanted to focus on this. Stephanie, you also had questions on unpaired carers, and then I'll come to the Gillian Mackay after you, Stephanie.
Yep. I'm wondering about how we make sure, how we actually go about as well getting that parity for unpaid carers who are carrying out different jobs, who have employment, who have different things. There's going to be a lot of us over the next few years with the change in demographics who are going to be looking at taking on a caring role. And I'm wondering how we actually go about showing and changing. I think Derek spoke earlier on about the kind of shifts in social care support and towards human rights and things. And I'm wondering about how we shift that ethos and that culture and society to actually really be valuing the care that carers provide.
And is that directed at Derek initially? Derek.
So I would take my advice on this from Fiona Colley. So I won't say too much and give Fiona the stage. I think there is something. So in the conversations we had with carers and carers groups, they asked us for a number of things. The first was recognition. Recognise our contribution. And so I think the more that we do that, and I think the Parliament can have a really important role there. It's just as recognising and celebrating the contribution that carers make. Never take that for granted. That would help, I think. Second thing is, this is one of the areas where a bit of standardisation is required. There's a lot of variation in the extent to which carers' assessments are done. So a lot of variation in the extent to which the agreements are then honoured. If we promise to do things with and for carers, we should deliver. I think that would help. And then the third thing is, as I said earlier, recognise that carers have human rights too, and help them do the vitally important work that they do by helping them into employment when they want to, helping them take a break when and if they want to, and just kind of easing that path. So those things would help. But Fiona's immersed in this day to day. We got most of our ideas in our report about carers from listening to Fiona and our members. So,
yeah. I'll hand over to Fiona now. Thank you, Fiona.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Derek. I think that point of recognition is extremely important. The role that carers have, the contribution that they make. But alongside that, I hear quite often from carers how frustrated they get. The hidden army, the unsung heroes, and it's actually the delivery of support that they need to be able to undertake their caring role safely so that it doesn't damage their health and well-being and that it enables them to carry on working if they want to do that, to go into education if they want to do that, but actually just to have an ordinary life where they can go for a swim, go and meet their friends,
have a break from caring. We know that during pandemic that about 75% of carers hadn't had any sort of break. And I'd like to say that that's unusual, but actually it's not. Even in normal times, carers struggle to get a break from caring. They struggle to get support or even recognition for their own health and well-being. We hear quite often from carers who actually neglect their own health and well-being as well. So they can't get support to even go to their own health appointments and to look after themselves as well. So I think there's kind of a kind of multifaceted point. I think that point about the adult care support plans and carers assessments, I think we started off with a challenge with the Carers Act. We developed this really positive approach of every carer being able to get an assessment if they needed one, not limiting it to regular and substantial. That was very much about preventative, about recognising when people needed support, recognising from the very beginning and actually planning, because there's some conditions of a person who's receiving support that we know what the trajectory looks like, and there's opportunities for support to come in rather than it being crisis. But then when you overlay that with eligibility criteria, you kind of break that because carers are a resource, and I hate to use that term, a resource, but they're a huge resource in providing social care in Scotland. We wouldn't think of saying to a care worker, oh, well, you can't have any holidays, you can't have any break from this. We wouldn't think of saying to a care worker, well, you can't be off if you're sick. We would provide occupational health. Well, I would like to hope that we'd provide occupational health if someone has an injury. We would provide the equipment people need, and we provide it at the earliest point. But we're not at that point yet. So what a national care service needs to deliver, first and foremost, is choice. Letting people choose what care that they want to provide, because it may be there's some level of care they want to provide and other things they can't do. And a support plan behind that. What is it that you need to have the life that you want, and to support the person that you love? And that's quite often it's about the person that you love. And how do you balance that out to ensure that your physical health and well-being your physical health and your mental health is not damaged, and where you have health and well-being needs, that these are met, and they're met quickly, because too many carers are quite simply breaking down, and this will have a long-term impact, because carers at some point will cease to be able to care because actually they've been damaged by the care that they've been providing. So I think we've got huge opportunities for the National Care Service. We've got huge opportunities to really change and really shift how we view carers, and to really get the support in behind them to say that we value care workers, but we value care unpaid care providers equally, and we'll provide the support that you need for that.
Okay, we are rapidly running out of time, and I know that there's some panellists want to come in, but if I don't have time to come to you, if you maybe want to follow up by email, if there's any pressing, because we have got procurement to talk about and the aftermath of COVID-19, but I'm going to bring in Gillian Mackay very quickly on the unpaid carers issue.
I think this should probably be directed at Fiona. Obviously, a lot of unpaid carers have been unable to take breaks, but I think there's been a significant impact of the pandemic, particularly on the mental health of unpaid carers. Myself, when I was caring for my grandpa, the shadow of the pandemic and the risk that my activities outside of caring for him posed for his health if I brought COVID into the house and things. What do you think we should be doing in the immediate term to make sure that unpaid carers' mental health and that risk of burnout is decreased to the greatest possible extent? And do you think that there are other things that we should be doing in terms of making sure that as we recover from the pandemic, unpaid carers don't continue to suffer unnecessarily?
Thanks. I think the point about mental health support is very, very important. I think from the beginning, we heard the distress of carers. We heard the distress and fear of that very point about if I do X, will that put the person that I care for at risk? If I go to the shop, will that put the person I care for at risk? So that very real fear, and to be honest, that continues. But you've got burnout on top of that. I'd like to see. It was good to see the National Wellbeing Hub includes unpaid carers, but we need more going forward. I think there's some short term things that could be done, because I understand the pressures around remobilising the NHS and some of the issues around mental health services, but actually have a plan for supporting the mental health of carers, get investment out to carer centres for emotional support to increase their capacity for them to, for example, spot purchase counselling, and some carer centres do have counsellors working with them. So actually just try and get get some money out the door and actually get a plan and get some money out the door to the centres who've been providing support the whole way through, and increase their capacity to be able to offer that, and that longer term plan of how the NHS provides that support as well. But we need to get that balance. But I think we also, as I mentioned earlier, we need to get some quick wins in how do we support carers. There's been investment going through, and I don't want to minimise that. But what do we need to do now to help carers through? Is that about increased flexibility and self-directed support, individual budgets to actually meet needs when care support isn't available or it's going to be delayed? So there is increased funding for carer centres for that emotional support and other things. It is about more money going into breaks to enable individuals, for example, to have a family holiday, could come and be linked in with the Tourism Scotland. But if you don't actually have funds, if you're on a low income, it's all very well to have a voucher, but you need funds to help with things like transport and things like that. So think about speaking to carers, what is it that you need, and try and get money out the door as quickly as possible.
Okay, we have some questions now on procurement and commissioning. It's Sue Webber.
Yes, thank you very much. I want to try and bring it all together into one question and contextualise it with something that happened over the weekend and certainly the press in terms of promoting that preventative support and collaboration and trying to integrate and use more innovative solutions. For example, I went to see the food train in West Lothian. And this is a question, I suppose, for Derek Freely and for Judith Proctor, given that Mr Freely had said there should be things we're doing now, and Judith with her role representing all of the IGBs. You know, we've heard at the weekend that for the first time in decades there was a 90-year-old woman that starved to death, and that the charities, in particular it was Age Scotland, said that it's desperately sad that it's highlighting the scale of pensioner malnutrition across Scotland, and it's harrowing stories from pensioners who talk of empty cupboards, problems with grocery deliveries, particularly among those who are not online. And I suppose that's why I'm trying to, what can we do now while we're waiting to repurpose these services to stop things like that happening again? Using the legislation that's in front of us now, what can we do in terms of commissioning and procurement in that regard?
Okay, I'll come to Judith first.
Yes. It's a very shocking story. I'm afraid I hadn't seen that, but it's a very, very important point. And we have touched, I think, on some of the questions about this earlier in the conversation, which is about that local approach and about how we truly work in partnership with third and independent sector and community groups, faith groups, people who are present in communities to create the kind of thriving, vibrant community in which people can participate, and where people are visible and seen. So I think that's a hugely important part of the considerations about how we resource a National Care Service and how we resource the sort of community that we want to see. We're doing some work, most of us in our health and social care partnerships, I think all of us, in the conversations that we've had about the lessons learned through COVID with our third sector organisations, third sector interfaces, and food poverty is very much a feature of that. How we support people who are housebound, how we support people in their communities is very important. And there are some
you know, brilliant examples. You mentioned the Food Train, you know, a long-standing organisation that have been doing that for a number of years in different parts of Scotland, but also in different partnership areas, other food-focused charitable organisations, third sector organisations doing that. I think the role of our day services, day centres in that is also important too. And come back also to the role of social work and how we're able to encourage people to come forward if they have got any concerns, if they are concerned about somebody, and how we're able then to signpost and support them to those vital services. So I think it is really, really important. It is one that is impacted by resources as well. So we obviously have to consider that and our ability to fund and support those organisations if we're going to create those networks and safety nets for people, particularly older people.
Derek?
Yeah, well, firstly, I agree that those kind of tragic events that you described should never happen. I think there are two sets of ways in which a radical reform of commissioning and procurement could help. The first, I guess, is around what we commission and procure. And at the moment, too often, that's very transactional, time and task. The result of the commissioning and procurement process is just a lot of 15-minute visits. And that's often not what people need. And so I think we need to turn our attention to what is it that we're commissioning and procuring, and how can we make that more relational and less transactional? How can we make it more preventative and less crisis oriented? And that would help. And then there's something I think about how we commission and procure, and a report makes some recommendations about that. We'd like to see a more collaborative approach. We'd like to take the market out of commissioning and procurement to some extent, at least. And if the market needs to play a role, then it ought to be much more actively managed. And we recommend a role for the care inspectorate in kind of market oversight insofar as the market exists. But we'd like to see that replaced with greater collaboration. We'd like to hear the user voice much earlier in the commissioning and procurement process. And the second kind of main focus in terms of how should we change commissioning and procurement is really around the ethics of it. And so there's a call in our report for ethical commissioning, so that commissioning and procurement can be used as a vehicle for fair work, which we've already talked about. But also placing a new set of requirements on care providers around transparency and a commitment to high quality and their participation in quality improvement activities. And those would all, in our view, be essential prerequisites of awarding public money to any care provider.
And can I come to Sandesh Gulhani, who has a question on procurement? Sandesh.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. So this is really directed at Derek Feely. In your summary, point 17 states, integration joint boards should manage GP contractual arrangements, whether independent contractors are directly employed. So my question is, in this model, would you want the GP workforce to be directly employed or independent contractors in your ideal vision that you've set out?
Derek.
We're not really envisaging that the employment status of GPs would change. Okay. So GPs would continue to be largely speaking independent contractors.
Okay, and how would the IJB manage the contract with independent contractors and those directly employed? What's the differences in that management?
I think we're really focusing there on local enhancements to the national contracts. So, as I'm sure you're aware, there are in bits of the country variations to the national contract. And we think it makes sense for at least some consideration to be given about it, enabling integration joint boards to manage those alongside the other contracts in health and social care that they will hold.
But do you think there'd be a difference between those who are directly employed and those who
Judith Proctor wanted to come in. If best to do this through the chair because it is quite difficult to manage. Can I bring in Judith Proctor first before I come back to you? Judith.
Yes, I was just going to put some of that question in context, because I think in practice, IGBs or health and social care partnerships through the teams are effectively managing much of the engagement, the relationship with the contract with GPs currently. Our primary care teams, so the work that's happened around primary care improvement plans, that's very locally driven within health and social care partnerships, and the direct management of 2C practices under the contract where GPs are employed. It's a far smaller number of GP practices, usually in specific circumstances, but they are managed within the health and social care partnerships, which all have through their IGBs, clinical directors and lead GPs around that. So there's already some of that management happening. I think the report, Derek's report in the NCS talks about the overall contract moving from boards to the new community health and social care boards for their oversight. Hope that's helpful. Okay.
I'll come back to you, Sandesh. This has to be your last question because we do need to move on to our final theme on COVID-19. Sandesh.
Just to directly ask again to Derek, would there be a difference in the IJB between those who are directly employed in the 2C contracts and those who are independent contractors, or is it going to be in much the same way?
I don't think what this is we did not envisage a significant change in the current arrangements as Judith described them. This was much more about making sure that in the spirit of integration, there was the facility and the capacity for integration joint boards to oversee GP contracts. And actually, Judith is much better able than I to describe the detail of that and how it might work. But we weren't envisaging here a massive shift in the current arrangements. This was much more of a kind of tidying up that we had envisaged.
Thank you.
Bring Judith back in and then we'll have to move on. Judith.
Yes, I would agree. I don't think the arrangements set out in Derek's report or the NCS consultation will make a big practical difference on the ground, because we are all largely overseeing that contractual relationship now.
And can I come to David Torrance, who has some questions around COVID-19 and social care?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to panel members. Over the past 18 months, the pandemic has caused pressures and difficulty on the social care sector. And what lessons can be learned from the experience of the social care sector during the pandemic?
And do you want to direct that? Maybe we come
Judith
to
Proctor, please.
Come to Judith. Okay, thank you. Judith.
Yes. Hugely important that we reflect and learn the lessons over the pandemic and the lessons that we're still learning now. As a group of chief officers, we undertook a piece of work with Scottish Government colleagues and contributed to the lessons learnt through COVID-19. We've done that individually within our partnership too. And of course, there was a range of other pieces of work that related to support and oversight of care homes and the access to PPE and those elements. I think what's been really important in this is the need for clarity in terms of our communications with the sector. I think that was very important in the work that we undertook with care homes, being able to have points of contact for those care homes where we could support them, and having a real clarity in terms of how we were supporting them to access and implement the guidance. I think it was also really, really important how we communicated with our own teams and the organisations that we work within, to make sure that we were being clear on what it was that we were doing, some of the challenges that those restrictions were bringing us, and the amplifying the national messages in terms of how we were operating through those restrictions, what we were asking people to do. was obviously very important that we were able to, for the care sector, to demonstrate the practical support through things like access to PPE, but also things like the sustainability payments, needed to make sure, as far as we were able, that we didn't see a significant level of gap in our ability to resource the sector. And I think that's been really, really important. That will remain important as we go through COVID, because we have seen impacts in terms of the capacity within care homes. We've seen impacts in relation to people leaving the sector, the increase in costs of recruitment. So I think the lesson in terms of ensuring access to appropriate resources to maintain the current level of service delivery is vitally important. I think also that the point that not every stage of the pandemic has been the same, I think we need to reflect on the different waves and the different parts of the pandemic. And I think it's equally important that we don't think that the pandemic is over and that we have learnt the lessons from it, because we're in a unique and differently difficult point in the pandemic now. So we probably need to be reflecting on this element too. What are we learning with COVID now, the impact of COVID, the tail of COVID as it goes on. And so important that we take points over time to reflect and not just think it's over and we've learned, because we have still got more learning to do.
Thank you. And can I come to Nick Watson?
I think one of the things that we found, because we interviewed across in Scotland 38 disabled people and 30 in England, and also in Scotland 20 organisations involved in social care, and the same number in England, twice during the pandemic to see what's going on. And I think one of the key things that happened with social care, one of the key learnings that happened is at the start, I think that I mean, admittedly, there was nobody knew what was going on. It was a very crazy, very difficult time. But disabled people seemed to, like I said already, those people in domiciliary care just seemed to disappear off the map. People told us how they felt lost, how they felt left out. And if it wasn't for the third sector stepping in, many people would have been in real trouble. And I think the third sector played such a key role in maintaining contact, in maintaining services, in providing support for disabled people. And we were told, people who were people working in social care, who were working for the local authority, who might have been working, for example, with people with a learning disability, were moved to care of the elderly. This was prioritised over community services. Lots of services for disabled people were just closed overnight. People's drama groups, people's art groups, people's cookery groups. Now, these might not seem important to most people, but these are a lot of people with learning disabilities. This is their only social contact. These are their community. And they were just closed overnight, and they were left without these communities. And it was took the third sector, who set up, karaoke groups. Glasgow Disability Alliance were running around the city, dishing out iPads or other things, teaching people how to do this and so on. And this worked in some areas, but and we can see there were huge differences in digital access. So in Glasgow, about 80% of GDA's clients, the GCIL's clients, I think, were digitally excluded. In Edinburgh, it was about 20%. So we had different sort of things going on. But I think one of the things that happened during COVID was that the need of disabled people just was forgotten about, because everybody was talking about, as I said, people were talking about that. Communities disappeared. And I think one of the other things that's happened is that informal carers were left to carry a lot of the support. And this relates back to the points that were made earlier. But short breaks were understandably, people's short breaks were stopped, but nobody thought, how can we go in and provide some other sort of short break? How can we provide somebody with an afternoon off to go out for a walk or something? I spoke to a mother of a 27-year-old who lived in Scotland, and she'd had this was in September, she'd had absolutely no contact from the local authority since March. She was looking after this young man on her own. She had nobody had attempted to short breaks, and she's close to breaking point. So I think that we've got these, you know, we people were left. And it was all right if people made a noise, but a lot of people didn't because they were so busy and so swamped. So I think one of the things that we really have to do is have to push this notion, the thing, domiciliary social care is very, very important. And it's something that needs to be driven to the top of the agenda. Also the other thing as well, that the third sector's role was central in this.
Can I come to him,
and many third sector organisations, sorry, just one final point. Many third sector organisations have managed with very precarious working conditions. You know, there are third sector organisations who are currently providing services without contracts. They're going on a month-to-month basis. And, you know, the precarity of employment in the third sector is actually, quite frankly, unacceptable with the way that we're treating workers in that sector.
And can I come to Henry Simmons? This will have to be our last contribution before we take a break. Henry, over to you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Chair. I think what I would like to say is that there was at the start, it was very clear that people would run out of money, run out of food, you know, have difficulty getting medications. And I think there was a general excellent level of collaboration to try and meet their needs. I also think it was important that some of the established services, like day services, some of the home care services that have already been talked about, there was a good bit of partnership working that allowed us to reshape services. So care inspector registrations, for example, were modified. Funding that was for daycare was allowed to be used for digital visits and digital technology support. But all of that, I think, was a good lesson that we can learn about collaboration and reacting to crisis, and we should sort of take some sort of like strong lessons from that. What I think we learned most of all was that the infrastructure around individuals that's out with, say, the mainstay of NHS just fell apart. And I think that what happened was that our experience was that people jumped forward almost at 2 or 3 years in terms of their time living with dementia. So people who were early stage needs just rapidly changed to sort of mid and later stages. That we've now got a population of people who are not yet diagnosed, who need diagnosis. We've got people who receive diagnosis whose needs have progressed. We've had a really significant number of people who have progressed to require advanced care support that we weren't predicting. And I think amidst all of that, we've seen things like significant excess deaths that we need to try and really understand. And a lot of that is about the importance of the non-pharmacological interventions that are around individuals and families. And if anything, it's the best example to show you that if you take away that social support, social infrastructure, all the things that make people have a quality of life and stop it instantly, the decline and the impact of that decline is so significant, it's really quite, I think, you know, it's quite frightening. And the truth probably is we'll find ourselves in the future in another situation where there'll be a pandemic of some kind, and we need to prepare for that and make sure that we don't just put everything, you know, dead stop and like then try and pick the pieces up, but we've got to try and taper it out. And that will mean, I think, you know, really resourcing the sector in such a way to cope with that in the collaborative way that we did, but perhaps in a more structured way going forward. Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks to everyone this morning. I've kept you an awful lot longer than we originally intended, but I think it's been hugely worth it, given the time to air quite a lot of these thoughts that will inform our work programme. We're going to take a break now, and back in 5 minutes.
Okay. Our third item today is a roundtable with stakeholders on health and social care finance, and this is intended to inform the committee's future work programme discussions and also to inform the committee's approach to pre-budget scrutiny. I'm going to start off with a slight apology in keeping our panellists waiting. You've been very patient. I'd like to welcome Lee Johnson, Senior Manager of Audit Scotland. Professor David Bell continues along with us from the last session, who's Professor of Economics at the University of Stirling. Siva Anandasiv, the Chief Analyst of the King's Fund, and David Walsh, Public Health Programme Manager for the Glasgow Centre for Population Health. Thank you to you all again for waiting and for coming to join us this morning to help us with our work programme. I'd like to ask all of you really to come in and to ask about if there's a greater scope in this landscape for prioritisation of preventative spend. I mean, given we're dealing with the aftermath of a pandemic, we're setting up a national care service, but time and time again it keeps on coming back that we don't prioritise preventative spend enough. And we heard from the last panel that when you do preventative spend, it actually saves money for the future and has better outcomes. But given that we have got this pandemic, we're in a bit of a crisis moment, you can see how it's difficult to square the circle there when you're actually dealing with immediate concerns. Can I go around all of you, if I maybe start off with Lee Johnson. Lee.
Morning, convener. Thank you. I think as we've reported before, obviously integration was intended to help shift resources away from the acute hospital system towards more preventative and community-based services. But I think as we've seen, that's not been easy to achieve, and we've reported that. I think there's been a lack of agreement about whether it's achievable in practice or whether rising demand for hospital care means that more resources needed across the system. And of course, with the huge backlog that we now see from the pandemic, I think it requires disinvestment and reinvestment, and as I've said, that's been very difficult to achieve up to now. But I think what the pandemic does offer is a chance to do things differently, to seize the opportunity and to think about how we can deliver things differently and in a more sustainable way going forward.
And can I come to David Bell?
Thank you, convener. I just echo what Lee has said. Part of this, I think, part of the difficulty of moving resources towards preventative spend, as the Christie Commission advocated several years ago, is being able to demonstrate the usefulness of such preventative spend and convincing managers that there is genuine resource savings to be made about allocating more towards preventative spend. That is a difficult task. It is not easy to make that convincing demonstration to those who feel that acute services are under pressure and require, you know, immediate support. We have in our earlier session, Henry Simmons talked about how lifestyle changes might actually reduce the negative effects of Alzheimer's progression, and you know, that seems now to be an accepted result, but it's difficult to persuade. It's just a reiteration of the same point. It is difficult to persuade managers that putting in place programs that may not see a successful outcome for years to come is worth doing. And you know, many countries have tried this, some with more success than us, perhaps. But it is a huge challenge.
And can I come to Siva Anandasev?
Thank you, convener. And I should say that I work for a think tank that's based in England. So I was going to say an awful lot, but almost everything I'll say will be based on an English context. And I'd make five quick observations. The first is, I think the logical case, the business case for investment, greater investment in preventative service and public health services has been made. The second thing is, as the other panelists have said, that doesn't seem to translate into that greater investment. And I would observe that things are held to different standards, aren't they? So if I was to propose the building of a new hospital, that won't see a benefit for 5 to 7 years in most cases, but I'm certain that business case will get through a lot easier than the case for a transformative impact increase in preventative spending. The third thing, though, is I think in England, at least for the first time, and I think we're following your lead in Scotland to a large extent, some of the structures are changing to support greater preventative spend. So we're forming integrated care systems where the basis of work is collaboration rather than competition for greater elective activity. I think the contractual frameworks will change. So we'll get off this hamster wheel of annual spending, and you'll have a sort of 3 to 5 year budget that does give you that headroom to invest in services that pay dividends further down the line. And perhaps more importantly, I think our expectation of what a leader is meant to do in our healthcare system is subtly changing from you run a good ship, you run a good hospital or an organization, to you are a system leader, you are thinking about the health of your population. But having made those optimistic points, I'd like to finish on two slightly more pessimistic points. In almost every conversation I'm in at the moment, the elective care backlog, the waiting list for planned hospital care, take up almost all the oxygen in the room. And that's for historical reasons. It's because that's where most of the data and performance targets are measured. And there's simply not enough funding available to parallel run two systems. A system that's focused on tackling that backlog, a system that's focused on transformative improvements in preventative spend. So I think at the moment, it's uncertain what the strategic priority of the system will be for the next 5 years. But as one chief exec put it to me, how I work out what my priorities are I think about what I get sacked for. And I can tell you now, over the next 5 years, it is more likely I will get sacked for not tackling the elective backlog than any other issue. So sorry, a mix of hopefully some hope and a little bit of pessimism.
Thank you. And can I come to David Walsh?
Yeah, thanks and good morning. I should preface this answer by saying I do research in the area of health inequalities, which is less around health service and more around the broader determinants of health. So I think if we're talking about prevention, you need to understand prevention in the really wide sense of the big social and economic drivers of poor health and health inequalities that exist. And so I think it's really important to look at the context here. So we talk about COVID and we talk about this crisis on the health service, but it's important to understand we were already in a crisis before COVID. So the impact of the UK government's austerity measures in taking out £47 billion across the UK from social security payments has had a devastating impact on health outcomes everywhere, and clearly in widening inequalities. So there's been talk about a stalling of improvement in life expectancy as one marker of population health, but we know that actually masks increasing death rates among the most deprived populations across the UK. So in terms of prevention, I think it's really important to understand that context, that even before COVID hit, we already had the widest health inequalities in Western Europe, but on account of the last 10 years, they've become a lot wider. So COVID has come and COVID will go, and we'll see the impact in terms of a couple of years of markers like life expectancy and mortality rates. But when we go back to pre-COVID rates, we were, as I've already said, in a crisis already. I think it's really important to understand that context.
Thank you. And David, you've picked up on some of the other issues that the colleagues are going to come in on, but certainly that I guess is what I was driving at, is the sort of interdependence of different portfolio areas in terms of government, in terms of having an impact on health outcomes, that you've picked up on the idea of like economic inequality having a direct impact, and you could say the same for educational inequality as well. So I guess the one of the questions, I'll just come back to David before I go to colleagues. Do you see that one of our panelists last week made the comment that every government minister is a health minister, and that you should be viewing your outcomes for health through the lens of absolutely everything else that you do. Your thoughts on that, basically? I mean, if we were to look at something like a universal basic income, what could be the impact on health outcomes there, for example?
So more generally, in terms of that question about does it all matter, do all these different departments somehow relate to health, that's a fundamental understanding of public health. So there are thousands of models of health determinants out there which have many, many factors in them. They include health services, but health services is only one of many things, and it's not the most important. What's the most important things are the kind of socio and economic areas that you allude to. So the evidence around the relationship between income and health, between employment and health, between education, having, you know, the conditions that you brought in are overwhelming, and they go back not just decades but centuries. So it's really important to understand that all these factors ultimately impact on health. And on one level, that's public health evidence. It's also kind of common sense in terms of, you know, that David Bell alluded to health behaviours there, but health behaviours don't emerge in a vacuum. They are about how you respond to the environment which you're in. So socio and economic factors are imperative. Income is imperative, and so things around minimum income for health are really, really important. There's work going on in various areas around trying to understand the ways that we can protect the poor, because this is fundamentally what it's about. And in again, coming back to austerity, the impact of the cuts on social security has been, as I said, absolutely calamitous in terms of taking away the safety net of the poorest and most vulnerable in society. I think what we have to do in the context of rather limited powers in that area is try to do what we can to protect the income and therefore the health of the poorest and the most vulnerable, using the powers we have, although in terms of social security, they're obviously very, very limited.
Thank you. We're going to come on to more in-depth discussions around some of the themes that you've all mentioned there. On the idea of the strategic context for health and social care finance, I'm going to come to my colleague Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thanks, Chair. I'm really interested in some of the early comments that were made by the panel there, but how do we give managers the headroom to deal with future and preventative care and providing an exceptional service, rather than them only having to deal with present conditions and the backlog?
I guess we should maybe just, if we come to do it in reverse order, if we come back to David, and I'll go through everyone. Otherwise, if people want to come in any of the future questions, you just put an R in the chat box, because I won't be able to go around absolutely everyone for every question, so that would be very helpful. So if I come to David Walsh first of all.
Yeah, doing this in the reverse order probably isn't the best for me, because as I say, my research isn't really around health service spend, which I did make the point when I was invited to come along, but they were keen for me to talk about other things, so there's probably others on the panel that can respond better to that. The areas I work in are more around, as I said, about the broader social determinants. And clearly, they are the factors that predict poor health in the first place, rather than just, you know, when you encounter the health services, you're already in that situation having poor health. I think if that's OK, I'll skip that question and leave others to respond to more those particular issues.
To Siva, then. Just get the microphone on for Siva Broadcasting. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Evelyn. So I'd say three things. One, that I think the headroom is for clinicians as well as managerial staff. And I think that was in your question as well. I honestly can't tell you the number of clinicians who say, that's the first thing that goes. We call them in this country SPAs or special programmed activities, that's basically my headroom where I can think about changing my service. And that's the first thing that goes because I'm back on the backlog. I think the answer, I'm picking up on some of the things that were said before, if we haven't got the right supply of staff, and we certainly don't in England, that headroom is incredibly hard to create. So until you increase the size of the workforce, you will always be in a hole. So that's the first point. The second point is, I think there is something about the technical information and skills and capabilities that we have. So things like, do you have the data, the integrated data that show you where you should be having the greatest impact? And in parts of the country, absolutely. If I go to Greater Manchester, they have all the inverted pyramids over this group of the population is relatively small, but accounts for a large amount of cost. If we were going to invest in more preventative spend, that's who we should be supporting the most. Other parts of the country lag far, far behind. So I think there's that technical data bit. And as part of that, I think giving people the capability for how you can improve services, because we've lost some of that ethos of lean thinking, operational thinking. But I think the third thing, and probably for me the hardest to get my head around, but also the most important, is culture and organizational development. And what particularly sticks in my head is talking to a group of consultant ophthalmologists, where I was trying to do the sell for more preventative investment, greater integrated thinking. And they said, look, we get it, you know, intellectually we get it. But for my entire career, I've been trained to focus on throughput, getting people in and out of hospital and my service as quickly as possible. I want to do things like tackle avoidable blindness. I want to do things like tackle unmet need. No one has yet told me, first of all, that is what my new job description is. So I want clarity over what behaviors should be rewarded. And secondly, how on earth I do it? What's step 1, 2, and 3? So I think the places I've been most impressed with, places like Greater Manchester, parts of Dorset, are the ones that have really invested in organizational development to support consultants working in a different way.
Thank you. And can I come to David Bell?
Reiterate what Silvia's just said around metrics. I mean, if all the metrics that clinicians are and other health professionals are confronted with are effectively around short-term acute issues, then which can be easily highlighted by reporters in the press, then it will be difficult to switch the attention away from acute budgets. There is the issue of long-term budgets. Again, we're about to have a spending review, but there has been very little consistency of budgeting, which is really a UK government messing around with the timing of budgets and their coverage and time. I agree with a lot of what David Walsh said, but the Scottish government's budget is increasingly dominated by health and sport. It now accounts for more than 40% of the overall budget. There used to be roughly the same level of spend on health as there was on local government. Well, for 2021, health and sport spend is forecast to be 17 billion, and for local government, 12.5 billion. So there's been a big change. So the opportunities to engage with that preventative activities that David talked about, has been much limited. I agree with the point about data. If you don't have the right data, this was a point I made in the previous session, if you don't have the right data, then you can't take the right actions. And the issue of silos in terms of different ministers or different government departments being responsible for spending their own money and not seeing that some of the resource that they're using would be better allocated to one of the other departments is a big issue.
I'm going to bring in Emma Harper, who has some questions on this theme.
Emma.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. I was just waiting on my camera and microphone being activated. We took evidence at the previous Health and Support Committee about shifting the balance of care, moving finances into like a social prescribing model. And one of the things that I was interested in is prevention of type 2 diabetes complications, because we spend lots of money mitigating complications or treating complications. £800 million is a lot of money when these are complications that are preventable. So I'm interested to know about how do the panellists, and maybe we start with David Walsh first, but it's what is the value of social prescribing, and should that really be invested in more in order to help improve the health and help tackle inequalities as well? So that's something that I'm interested in, just because of our previous committee work around social prescribing.
And you wanted to go to David Walsh first.
Yes, please.
Yeah, thanks for the question. So there's some emerging evidence that's quite kind of local around the effectiveness of social prescribing, I suppose. In relation to that specific question, and then in relation to how you've led it into the bigger question about health inequalities more generally, I think it's about a kind of balance. So if some GPs are prescribing social kind of remedies, well, that might work in some cases, but where, as I've alluded to, there's a crisis in basic social security funding, then it's not gonna address that balance. So it really depends on individual cases in that sense. And clearly, if people are having their income taken away, then being told that, you know, a walk would be good for them, I'm not trying to belittle it, but you know, it depends how that fits with that individual circumstances. More generally, when it comes to the issue about health inequalities and what we do about them, there's a really important point to note, which is we know what to do about them because the evidence is all out there, and the Scottish Government themselves commissioned a policy review, an international policy review of what works to address inequalities and what doesn't work. And that was undertaken by NHS Health Scotland, which is now Public Health Scotland. And so that's all published about 4 or 5 years ago. And so we know that there are different levels where policies are effective. So policies that address the fundamental socioeconomic drivers of health inequalities. So that's about the stuff I've mentioned around redistributing income, protecting the income of the poor, addressing poverty. There's other kind of more what they refer to as environmental areas. So in terms of housing policies, in terms of air pollution, these kind of things, taxing alcohol, et cetera, et cetera. And there's some issues around addressing individuals' experiences of inequalities. But the most important are about addressing those fundamental socioeconomic factors that drive health inequalities. The issue, though, is you get into this discussion about, well, so first of all, the evidence is there what works, so you need political will and political bravery. But then also in the devolution context, you have to ask the question of what power Scotland has to actually bring about those changes, introduce those policies. So to address those kind of more fundamental socioeconomic factors, do we have sufficient economic levers? And I think that's kind of questionable. So the evidence is there. It comes into political will and political powers, I think.
And Lee Johnson wanted to come in. Lee.
Can you hear me, Convener?
Yes, we can.
Yes, thank you. It was just really to follow up on David, I think, in terms of the role of Public Health Scotland. And obviously, they were set up just, you know, at the start of the pandemic, and obviously have been at the forefront of dealing with the pandemic. But I don't think they've had the opportunity yet to do what they were set up to do in terms of that whole system approach to public health. So I think it will be good to see what they can achieve once they're able to do what they were set up to do. But I also just wanted to comment, I think, on the wider approach to this, and Judith Proctor talked about it in the previous session, As I said, integration authorities were set up to try and move the funding into the community to more preventative care. But there's a number of areas that we identified in our integration report in terms of how that could be achieved, and that's around, and again, some of this has already been talked about, the need for collaborative leadership, systems leadership, rather than thinking about the aims of a single organisation and actually thinking more about the outcomes that you're trying to achieve for your community. I think some around the effective strategic planning as well, linking your resources to the priorities, and also then being able to link those to the outcomes that you're achieving. But as has also been mentioned, is data, is the need to have access to good data. And again, we've reported on a number of occasions that there's still a lack of data in terms of what's happening in community, in communities, in primary care, in social care, and being able to show the outcomes of these preventative approaches is important.
Thank you. Can I come to Gillian Mackay?
Thank you, convener. How best do we determine the level of funding that NHS and social care need after COVID? I know that the VMA have said that short-term boosts won't be enough to deliver the full recovery that services need, and that what's really needed is a full review of health and social care spending in the context of a national conversation about our expectations. Would the panel support this approach?
And who would you like to go to first?
Could we go to Lee first, please?
Thank you. If we can just bring up Lee.
Hello.
Thank you.
Is it for me?
Yes.
Yes, thanks. Sorry, it's difficult to tell. I think there has, obviously, as David said, health funding was already a huge proportion of the Scottish Government budget, and that's increased through further spending throughout COVID. And I think we've said on a number of occasions that the NHS was not sustainable before the pandemic, and costs have continued to increase throughout the pandemic. But I think there is continued uncertainty about how it will be funded going forward. Obviously, the Scottish Government have made a number of spending commitments, both in the recovery plan and in the programme for government. They talk about 20% increase over this parliament. But I think what we need to see is a refreshed medium-term financial framework for health and social care. But I think, as you say, it's also important in any way that we approach this, that we bring the public along with them, because in terms of recovery and sustainability going forward, things are going to have to be delivered differently. And of course, that needs a culture change amongst the public. So I think it's really important that we engage with the public and bring the public and staff along with us in terms of delivering services differently going forward to ensure the sustainability of the NHS going forward.
And Siva wants to come in.
Thank you, convener. So I think Lee's spot on. Absolutely, there needs to be a refresh of the UK's medium-term forecast for health and care spending. I think the one caveat I would say to I completely understand the criticism people have made about tactical short-term booster funding. One finance director said, because of this, my financial plan moves from a cliff edge to a cliff face, because money comes at short notice that I suddenly have to spend in a value for money way. The one thing I would say is Lee mentioned uncertainty. I can't emphasize enough how hard it is to develop a medium-term financial forecast that you can plan on with this level of uncertainty over demand, not just because we still don't know what the path of the disease will be, but also we don't know when demand for routine services will come back, in what complexity that demand will present, and how it will spread over time. So I think there is a question over when is the best moment to have that medium-term plan. And I would suggest that you're looking at the start of the next financial year at the absolute earliest. And I think then the second bit beyond timing is, what is it you want to plan for? And for me, increasingly, I'm starting to segment it into there are still direct costs of dealing with the pandemic. So things like test and trace systems, PPEs, that's the first bit. The second bit is tackling the backlogs, and I mean that broader than just standard active care. I mean things like mental health services, child and adolescent mental health, community care, you name it. The fourth thing is resilience. So what would a resilient health service, health and care service look like? And not just resilience to a pandemic, but resilience to other threats like cybersecurity. And that's a pet concern of mine, that as you see the shift to more digital and virtual consultation as the default mode, what redundancy are you building in and what does that cost? And the fourth and final one is the business as usual growth in healthcare spending, which tends to go up by 3 to 4% due to a combination of factors. And so you almost have to bake that in before you layer in these other cost pressures. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to David Bell?
I'm actually going to agree with Lee and Siva. You've got this 3 to 4% growth annually. In our earlier session, I alluded to what the part of the problem there is, the aging of the population and the concomitant largely chronic diseases associated with that. We really don't know at what rate the unmet need, which was clearly there during the pandemic for non-pandemic related healthcare, is going to be unwound, and that will have an important effect on funding requirements. We're currently, the budget for 21-22 is for 17 billion to be spent on health and sport, and our income tax receipts, which are our largest tax, are for 12.25 billion. So it is an issue around funding is a really important issue for the Scottish Government to address, the danger that, well, how to engage with the public and with staff around this inevitable growth in demand against the needs of other parts of the Scottish Government, like education and local government and so on.
I'm going to bring in Emma Harper for a very quick supplementary before I move on. Emma.
Thanks, Gillian. I don't have a sup, actually. That was just a correction of a spelling mistake in the chat function.
Okay. Okay, I'll bring in Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I mean, I think that discussion really begins to help us to think about the context of coming out of the pandemic and indeed what's going to happen moving forward. I'm quite interested in terms of service redesign. I think we touched on that in the previous answers, but I think it's about what can we learn from the pandemic, but do you think doing things differently, which will then have a saving attached to it. So particularly, I think, around digital. And in the context of social care as well, I think, you know, technology-enabled care is quite interesting as well. So I really just get a sense of where we think the opportunities are for some of that.
Okay, we'll maybe go to Lee first of all. Lee?
Thank you. I think there are opportunities. Obviously, you know, there has been some advances during the pandemic, as you said, in terms of digital, in terms of redesign of how people access urgent care, the A&E system, for example. But I think we have to balance that. I mean, there are opportunities there, but I think there's also huge increases in costs. And I think it's just how many of those costs will become recurring, as some of the panellists have already talked about, you know, the vaccination programme, test and protect, the increased infection prevention and control measures, so, you know, PPE, cleaning, social distancing, have hugely increased costs that will be offset of any potential savings that are to be made, I think. You know, also against that, as we've also talked about, the huge backlog of patients that still need to be seen, and of course the investment required to progress digital technology as well will lead to increased costs and investment. But I think it's important as well that we properly evaluate some of these innovations that have happened during the pandemic to make sure, you know, obviously it won't suit everyone, to make sure that they are meeting the needs of the population, but also that they're sustainable in the longer term as well.
And I'll bring in Siva.
Thank you, Convener. So I think an overarching point that, as Louise indicated, this is largely an evidence-free zone. So there are a few real-time studies collecting real-world evidence, but nothing that, to be honest, I would rely on before planning massive service changes. I think there are three buckets in England that people are looking at for productivity improvements that was spurred by the pandemic. The first is, as Paul mentioned, digital and particularly virtual appointments for primary care and outpatient care. It's certainly not finished, but the early evidence I've seen suggests that there is clearly a wider societal benefit to reduce travel time, reduced emissions, needing to take less time off work. The impact on NHS productivity is much more equivocal, including whether you can really reduce the number of dropped appointments or appointments where the patient did not attend. So I think it's, and clinical productivity as well. So I think there are the real questions around that need to be answered. The second area is about more operational changes. So in this country, we've seen a lot more of things like sharing a single clinical rota or sharing equipment, particularly larger equipment like CT or MRI scanners, across a wider pool of organizations. That has seen, I think it's not much talked about, but it's seen a reduced downtime for those assets, which has led to some productivity improvements. And the third area is service reconfiguration on a broader sense of what services are delivered where. And because of the pandemic, many countries separated out banned routine services, particularly in hospital, from what we call hot services, where it's an emergency, harder to predict, their patient coming in for trauma through an A&E department. And there are productivity benefits to separating those out. The pandemic has made that possible. But I think these are the three sort of train tracks that we're trying to build more evidence around. But I would say, finally, Lee's point about infection control, I think that's the rate limiting factor. Infection control guidance, at least for the next 6 months, will be the rate limiting factor, how much productivity a health system can deliver.
Just checking with Paul, because he is remote. Paul, did you want to come back on any of that?
No, I think that's helpful. Okay. Got some questions on sustainability, but we can move on to
that's fine. We were going to talk about the financials. We're going to talk about the financial sustainability aspect of all of this, and we've got, kicking that off, Sue Webber.
Yeah, thank you very much. I suppose mine's more of a generic one, I suppose. Sorry, Convener. It's just to ask the panel for their thoughts on Cosla's comments that the consultation cuts through the heart of governance in Scotland and will have serious implications for local government. I know maybe the first person can be Lee from Audit Scotland, because they've been quite...
talking about the consultation, are you talking about the social care?
I'm just aware of time, I was just talking about the finance in general.
Of finance of...
In terms of their thoughts on the consultation, the and how that would impact...
Which consultation? For the National Care Service? Yeah. Right, okay.
If you don't want to come in, you don't want to ask, I can...
No, that's fine. It's just that I thought it was more general points. But if anybody wants to come in on that, please let me know.
I did ask Lee, but I don't know if she wants to.
Lee, did you want to come in on that? I know it's not really the theme that we were on, because that was the last panel, but if Lee wants to come in on that, that's fine.
Yes, I think I've been unmuted. Just to say, obviously, I have to be cautious about what I comment on at this stage. So we are in the process of drafting a response to the NCS consultation. You know that we've said that changes in how social care are provided in Scotland are needed, but the solutions are far from simple. But I think the other thing is that the new models of care that are required will cost more money, and it's not clear how they'll be funded. But around the governance arrangements, I'll not comment at this stage.
Okay, and David Bell wanted to come in.
Just to say, I suppose I'm less constrained than Lee. I listened to Derek Feely in the earlier session making a very good case for the National Care Service, but I do worry a little bit around what that leaves for local government, because their functions will be further depleted as a result of this, the establishment of the National Care Service, having already lost police and fire services. And it seems to me that, you know, there is an issue around attracting people into local government, both in terms of professionals and elected members. And as functions are drawn away, the attractiveness of that route seems to me to be potentially declining, and would need some further investigation, it seems to me, because we are a relatively centralized country, and further centralization always seems like an issue that ought to be considered very carefully on democratic grounds.
Bringing it back to the financial sustainability of NHS boards, you want to come back on that? If we could focus on that, that would be helpful for this session. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll bring it back in then. We spoke there about the centralisation in Scotland, but it is also very diverse, and we've got... So in terms of trying to identify how we might want to change how NHS boards are allocated their money, because that's one of the issues with integration right now, that the money goes from the acute service to the primary care and social. So what other models are you looking at in terms of, or what might be considered as best practice, I suppose, looking across other areas?
And who would you like to direct that to first?
Why don't we ask the King's Fund? Sorry, my lenses have gone and I can't see any of the faces at the moment.
Okay, Siva.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'm really sorry. I lost the last half of the question. So I got as far as allocation to acute services that then gets devolved to primary care.
It was just what other models of funding might be appropriate for us looking at this National Care Service. Okay.
Great. Thank you. Thanks for that. So I'd say with the caveat that I've never seen a model that is demonstrably better than the other. I think there are other models that include, so in this country, I'd say we're broadly looking at three different models. One is a contractual model that binds together health and care organisations broadly for the totality of their services. So take a patch like Greater Manchester, let a contract that basically says all of you organisations have to work together to improve the health and well-being of the population of Manchester, and you get a single lump sum allocation that you then decide as a local system how you want to divvy up to best meet that goal of improving the health and well-being of the population. The second model we're looking at is more structural, so merging organisations together so a single budget is used, but it's not a contract binding different parts of the system together. The different parts of the system are now one organisation, and if you look at parts of Birmingham, you've got primary care services working as part of the acute hostel together with community services, basically an integrated provider. And the third model is much more disease specific or patient cohort specific, which is, for example, there was a contract in Staffordshire for cancer services, where again, rather than binding everything together, it was come together to plan how you would improve the health and well-being and essentially mortality and morbidity of patients with cancer. If I'm being honest, of all of those, I've not seen any evidence that one is better than the other, partly because I'd say two reasons. First of all, you can do whatever you want, but if you haven't got the wider conditions for success, which are enough staff, long-term planning, and clarity of the strategic direction of travel, then the contract can't overcome all of those. And the second element is much less technical, purely down to leadership. So if I look at parts of Tameside and Glossop, and I see how they've come together across the council and the NHS to tackle rough sleeping, the contract and the structure came years after leaders coming together to say, our current model is broken, because basically people who are sleeping rough are ending up in hospital because we're cutting services like bed and breakfast provision. What if we were to say that there's one Manchester pound and the best way to invest that is to have those preventative services? And they sorted out the contract afterwards. So it was culture before form. So I think that it is worth looking at a menu of options, but with the recognition it can get you so far.
Can I pick this up? I mean, obviously the system that's used at the moment in Scotland is the NRAC formula. And I'm just wondering if any of our panellists would like to highlight some of the issues that there are with that, because that is the crux of the matter, is that's the formula that's been used right now. But what else is out there that might actually address some of the concerns that there's been around that formula? And I'm looking for anybody that wants to come in first on that. Can I come to David Bell?
Okay, so I'm thinking this is the allocation to health boards, which is basically driven by the kind of formula that also drives allocations to local government, which is essentially around estimates of need, principally driven by population, but then by say demographic structure, levels of deprivation, and so on. I've had a lot of experience with these kinds of formulae. Whether you can fine tune them to improve their performance, clearly there are areas that feel they are hard done to in relation to this. There was a long period, I think, where Grampian felt that it was getting insufficient money given the issues that it faced. I think part of the problem is that a lot of this is hidden. People don't understand how these determinations are made, and bringing this out into the general public discourse so that there was some understanding would be useful. But I would hesitate to say, oh yes, I've got a better formula that will result in a reduction in Scotland's health inequalities in the near future. It's really, I think, a wider problem than that. And it goes back to our earlier discussion about social and economic circumstances, which will not be resolved simply by allocations to health boards.
Bring Siva back in.
Thank you, convener. Just to agree with Professor Bell and to try and provide a shorter but better answer to the question than I did before, which is we use a very, very similar resource allocation formula in England, which is broadly weighted capitation. You can tweak the parameters and inputs, how much weighting is given to deprivation. I have not seen a fundamentally better way of allocating healthcare resources than weighted capitation with the usual components of deprivation and age. So I would say if you want to fundamentally change things, there's as much to be done in how that money is used once it's been allocated to a health board, then changing how the money is centrifuge will be flung across the country.
Thank you. Thank you. And David Walsh wanted to come in.
Yeah, it was just a very brief follow-on from what David Bell said. And I agree with what he said in terms of the complexity of how these things are measured. But one of the things they do is try to take into account deprivation. And I would just add on to that, that deprivation is not measured terribly well in some respects. And I think also what's happened in the last 10 years in terms of, as I mentioned before, the impact of austerity, is that we're not capturing some of those additional levels of poverty, which also interact with some really kind of pertinent issues at the moment in terms of the really high rates of drug deaths, for example, that we're seeing in particular areas like Dundee, which have measures of deprivation that are similar to other places that don't have those issues. So I'm not suggesting I know a better formula, as has been hinted. It's very complicated, but I think there are some potential tweaks around understanding aspects of deprivation that the current formula maybe isn't quite picking up.
Yeah, thank you. And I certainly hear that around rural poverty as well in my area. I'm going to come to Sandesh Gohani, who has got some questions around financial sustainability. Sandesh.
I wanted to just ask about the way that the money is used. So my understanding is a board gets its money through its funding. This is then divided up into its allocations, into its divisions, and allocated. And so with the persons, with the money, the thing I always hear is clinicians saying that they're not able to use that money. So my question really is about who is the determinant of how that money is spent? Is it clinicians? Or is it managers, and who do you feel it should be?
And who would you like to direct that to, first of all, Sandesh?
Can I start with David, please?
David Bell or Walsh?
Walsh, sorry, David Walsh.
David Walsh.
I think the correct answer there was Bell, because I don't do any research into aspects of health funding within the NHS board, so the other David may be a better bet for this.
Thank you.
Okay.
It's maybe not my first choice subject either, but clearly there has to be clinical input around the decisions that are made by health boards, but there also has to be an overall strategic view, and it has to reflect the challenges within the area that are faced, and I would suggest that it's not always the case that clinicians have the strategic picture of what's happening, so that there has to be somewhere where these views are all brought together and decisions are made. Clearly clinicians have to be involved, but it's not entirely clear to me that it should be clinician driven.
We're going to go on to our final questions, and Stephanie Callan has some more questions around integration of health and social care.
Thank you, convener. I'll direct this to Lee and Siva. I think probably primarily, or you can correct me and come in and suggest something else. And I'll also mention that I'm an elected councillor at South Lanarkshire as well. Earlier on, we heard Lee speaking about the systems management approach. And currently, certainly, we have IJBs and we have health and social care partnership directors who've got quite a difficult role there as well, working between chief executives in health and also in local councils too there. And certainly pre-COVID there's been some success in freeing up hospital beds through preventative care and upskilling staff, preventing admissions, quicker hospital discharges, and kind of shifting some of that funding into care and treatments that are delivered in patients' homes. And I'm wondering how, moving forward with NCS and the much bigger scope that we're looking at there, how do we achieve that much bigger shift from hospital to community care? And how is it we make that funding work and get the right culture and ethos in place for that to happen? Thanks.
And that was directed at Lee initially, am I right?
Lee and Siva.
Yes. Lee.
Thank you. Yes, I recognise what you're talking about. As you know, South Lanarkshire was one of our case studies in our integration report, and the moving of money and reducing hospital beds. As I said again, I can only refer to our previous report around integration, and I think it's important that we learn the lessons from what has been difficult through health and social care integration. The collaboration and agreement, I think, that's needed for the reforms going forward has been difficult to achieve elsewhere. And I think that the six key areas, again, I'm going back to those that we identified, still have much relevance for the proposed reforms. So, as I was saying, the collaborative leadership, trying to encourage people to think about the outcomes of their community rather than, what they're trying to achieve for a single organisation, around good financial planning, longer term financial planning, so that you can, as we've already talked about, plan some of that disinvestment and reinvestment that's required to shift resources from the acute hospital into community, effective strategic planning, making sure that your priorities are linked to your resources and that you're clear about the outcomes that you're trying to achieve. The other area that we identified, of course, was around agreed governance and accountability, particularly around clinical governance, for example, being clear about where the decisions lie and when someone's no longer responsible for something. The issues around data as well are still key. How can we appropriately share data across the system so that people don't have to repeat their story? But of course, the other issue is a lack of data to understand what is going on in community care, social care and primary care makes it difficult to understand activity and plan for what needs to change and the outcomes that you're trying to achieve. And I think the other thing, as we've already talked about, is that ongoing, meaningful and sustained engagement with the community, with the public, with the service users. As I've said, we need to take them along with us in terms of the way that we reshape services, because it does need a culture change within the public as well as staff.
Stephanie, you wanted to address Siva as well.
Yeah. Thank you. So I'll say four things very quickly. One, as Lee said, be absolutely crystal clear on accountability. So are you now, as a board, jointly accountable for the entire pathway? Because the default otherwise will be, once the patient has been medically fit for discharge and has left the organisation, my accountability as a clinician ends. So crystal clarity over the accountability. The second thing would be, I think there is a strong argument for building outwards slowly from particular services or opportunities where there's better evidence that joint working works. So I think safe discharge into a new setting is one, a second would be around end of life care, and a third would be around rough sleeping. And I say that just because I've seen too many instances where the health and care organisations come together to try and either boil the ocean or focus on things that are really an NHS specific issue. And I vividly remember a councillor saying, why am I sitting in meetings for 3 hours talking about a joint venture and pathology? This has got nothing to do with me. End of life care. I can absolutely see why we need to all be in this room. The third one, speaking to the point. Been doing than any big strategic change program, and they include just making sure you spend time together. There is one group of chief execs in the southwest of England that every Friday afternoon they carve out to spend time together to understand each other's and all we need is to trust each other. We don't have to get along or even like each other, but we do need to trust and understand each other. There have been quite tactical tasks that have been set for organisations like go away, everyone in this health board, health and care board, go away and make one decision by the next meeting that is to the detriment of your organisation, but the benefit of the system. And the third thing tactically is, I've seen time and time again that people who train together and learn together in some way work better together. So opportunities for joint training and working. So the fourth and final thing, though, is about almost a reality check. And almost every piece of evidence I've seen is quite clear that integrated care can deliver better value and a better value outcome for the inputs we give a health and care system. There's very, very ropey evidence that it saves money. So if the task for assessing people is improve value, great. If it's take loads of cash out of a system, I think that's going to create the wrong dynamic and the wrong tension, setting them up to fail.
Thank you. We've come to the end of our time today. I want to thank all of our panellists from this panel and the one before for the time that they spent with us. It's been very valuable as we think about our work programme and, of course, our financial scrutiny of the upcoming budget. So our next meeting on the 5th of October, the committee will consider a legislative consent memorandum and we'll discuss that future work programme. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.